You are about to participate in the most ambitious culinary experiment ever imagined.
This competition is going to test everything.
Adapt quickly to anything. I mean anything. The wildest day of your life starts right now.
All new 24 and 24 Last Chef Standing. Sunday night at 8 on Food Network. Stream on Max.
About me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's Clarence
time. Let's get ready to rumble. Feel the fires of the rare. It's my son only know how to wear.
What is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another edition of Just Another Friday Night. I'm one of your two hosts, CM Chuck.
And I'm Double A.
Guys, it's been a while, right?
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Happy 2024. Yeah. I keep forgetting it's
2024. Yes, sir.
I was sick last week, guys. I was sick on New Year's Eve, and I did not get really better until about 2 days ago. So I'm not drinking because I want to get my immune system back to good. But yeah, Double A last week was like, dude, just get better. And I was like, yeah, totally the right move. But Double A, how the hell are you, bud? How was the week?
Good. A little windy, a little cool.
Yeah.
And it's going to get worse next week.
Yes, totally, man. Totally.
I think for everyone in the country. So.
Yeah, I know. It feels like, oops, pop that up right now. We'll talk about that in a second. But yeah, definitely some comments have already rolled in. Of course, Toy Mafia in the house saying, yo. And our boy Sam Gist says, what's up? What did he say there?
What up, boys?
What's up? Sorry, guys. You know, I don't wear my glasses when I'm doing this thing here. And this is some good stuff here from Sam for our collecting weekly auxiliary folks. Sam says, what if we lived in a world where Dean didn't lose his remote, Ben wasn't racist, and Marco did not have to hide or justify his purchases? Marco does some shows with his girlfriend or whatever, and the guy's got like four of those like $400 jokers, and it's like, ooh, I think sometimes she comes on and it's like, no, I don't think so. Really? You're not buying no more. So it's all good. Punisher XS in the house says, yo, hey, what's up, Punisher XS? Happy New Year's, boys.
In a show, maybe
could be Joe, could be Jerry. Happy New Year's, primos. That sounds like Yelly. Hi, Yelly. How you doing?
What's up?
Then we have Yo.
That is you. We're almost time for Royal Rumble.
There you go, guys, in the wrestling world, right?
We're supposed to have a get together. So.
Nice. I'll probably come for that event. I love to see the Rumble. The Rumble's always a fun event.
I mean, AJ's back, Orton's back, Punk's back.
Yeah.
Cody's back.
I mean, yes.
And we might see The Rock.
Might see The Rock, right? Potential setups for future stuff there.
It's going to be
there.
A really good Rumble this year.
Rumble is always a great, fun event.
The
so love that.
It
confirms it is her indeed. I'd like to know who everyone else is. If you can tell me, Happy New Year, boys. And then also, Happy this one that says yo. Maybe. It could be Jerry. Could be Joe.
Ceviche
or what? Yo, ceviche for show.
You better believe it.
For show, ceviche.
The only way I can eat shrimp. She's the only one that can make it where I can eat shrimp.
Oh, really? You're not a shrimp guy.
I tried it.
Okay.
Fried, regular, lemon pepper, coconut, all kinds of ways. Did not like it.
All right.
Nelly put it in her ceviche. And I swallowed it down like nothing.
There you go. So, I got to make some my shrimp, Cassie. We'll see.
I don't know, Charlie, man. I tried it. Like you said, all ways. I've tried it. And just by itself, man, it's hard. And it's funny because I like lobster.
Ooh, I love lobster.
And I'm like, people.
It's funny because those things like crawfish, lobster, shrimp, to me, they have a very, once they're like bear, a very similar taste.
That's
I get it.
People kind of get weird when I say I like lobster, but I don't get shrimp.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I get it. To each their own preference.
I wanted to like it. I like almost every other kind of seafood. So
there you go. Double A, how the hell was your New Year? Did you have a good New Year?
It was good. It was fine. It was football. football all day on New Year's Eve. So yeah,
and kind of a rare that we had football, like NFL football at that time, right?
Yes, yes. So
just the way the day stacked up,
it was okay. You know, I mean, everyone was with their families pretty much, so it was fine. You know, it wasn't too bad. I had shrimp with deviled eggs. It was good. Ooh, wow,
that
wow.
sounds.
Have you ever put a shrimp on a deviled egg?
No, I. Well, no? Number one, I hate eggs.
That's right.
Especially deviled
that's
eggs.
That's right. That's right.
So
that's
yeah, right. Like when people talk to me about eggs, they're like, "What is it? Is it the smell? Is it?" I'm like, if I were to think of one that I liked the least, it would be that one. I was like, because I really do find the smell.
I don't like
either.
No?
No. Okay. No, no, yeah, in my house, they're popular, and I hate when they make them.
I don't
them.
Like whatever that shit they put on there, and then I don't like the yolk.
Yeah, no. Yeah. So you're not a hard-boiled egg person no. either. Yeah.
I can eat the I can eat the egg, but the oak yolk, I'm like,
yeah,
that's fucking
yeah.
gross.
No, not for me. Not for me. Like I said, but shrimp, though, definitely. Like cocktail shrimp, grilled shrimp. Coconut shrimp, I don't particularly care for because I don't like the sweet.
I wanted because it just sounded good.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I didn't even taste the coconut. So.
Yeah. Grilled shrimp.
Come on, Red Lobster. Yeah. Get on the ball there.
I'm like a shrimp soup, shrimp gumbo, shrimp sandwich, shrimp po' boy. But good New Year. yeah. Better than mine. I was sick. I'm glad you had a good time. I got to see you, which was nice.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was trying not to infect anybody if I had anything, but I didn't. I didn't have COVID.
I live so close to CM that I'm like, you know. I might as well just go see him pop in for like a minute or two, which usually it doesn't last a minute or two, it lasts longer, but still.
Yeah.
So this is people like deviled eggs.
All right then.
I don't know.
We have Latinos also.
We have a big Mexican family, and whenever somebody makes them, those fucking shits go.
It's like a hit. Yeah.
I'm like, they're like, wow, it's like a fucking what do you call it? Like a special hors d'oeuvre.
Yeah, no kidding. I'm like,
man, people are just like, oh,
yeah. Just about anything else, and no eggs for me, but
no eggs and no shrimp for me.
I guess the one thing AA about a week off for us, you know, with a sick week, is that plenty of news happened or whatever. And I know I wanted to, we kind of saw a glimpse of it there, but obviously huge sports news came out. With you know, I would say this might be one of the definitely the biggest to happen or whatever, right? Legendary college coach and good coach in the NFL for a little while
did
too, coach, right?
But more college and wow, what a run he did with Alabama.
Yes,
probably never going to see anything like that again.
What was it? Seven national titles. I'm sure this is an insane number.
I didn't really
number.
Follow it, but I mean, pretty much if you were great, if you were good. And you went to Alabama and you played under Nick Saban, you're going to go to the NFL. Like, that was almost like a ticket to the NFL right away. Yeah. And now I know there was a few players that were committed to Alabama. Now they're kind of pulling out because he's not coaching anymore.
So. Yeah. I mean, you know, you want to play
you want to play under the man.
I don't follow college football, but he's one of those legendary names you just know.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think, was it you that told me to watch the Bill and Nick, the Belichick and Nick Saban special that was on? It might have been like a 30 for 30 or something like that.
No, because I didn't watch that one.
Okay, I watched that, it was really solid. Like, it showed, like, their records, like, head-to-head, like, they just have this legendary friendship and kind of a rivalry, and I was like, wow, like, they even had a pretty good, like, I mean, obviously, Nick Saban didn't have the professional success that Bill Belichick had, but, I mean, obviously, he did it in college, but their records against each other were pretty
even. College is so big, though. You've been to the UT game, right? Oh, when UT was shit hot.
Yes.
They're filling up stadiums just like the NFL, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's pretty damn good. It's a big deal, you know, that, you know, what this man accomplished.
Absolutely. So we're seeing, you know, again, if you lived, and you're a college fan, and you lived in, you know, and obviously in our lifetime, I mean, you probably see,
I mean, it
this
was big
guy's
news.
Game.
It was fucking big.
Huge news. Yeah. I mean, we're seeing a passing of a legend, for sure. And again, right on that note, just mentioning the man right there again, and I brought my Patriots beanie to show love and respect to my Patriots, but yeah, the man himself, Bill
Belichick.
And it feels
like this was the only way they were going to, you know, kind of remove him was by doing this.
Yeah.
I think if you probably asked the man, he'd probably be like, no, I'm good. I can coach him more. You know, I think this was the only way. I mean, they did it with Tom Landry, you know what I mean? You know, or they let him go. So, I mean, fired him, whatever you want to say.
Yeah.
Well, here they say they decided to
part ways. Yeah, you know, like a mutual splitting. Do you think that Belichick will coach more, or you think he's done?
Man, I think, man, he should just ride the sunset, man.
I think so, too. Yeah.
I mean, but people have said, you know, Atlanta would be a good spot. You know, despite them not making it under his other coach, that they actually have a good team. They say Tennessee would also be a good spot for him, too. They have, like, a really solid team that could use a coach like him. So they are.
Okay, sorry about that, everyone. Of course, technical difficulties, the joys of being live.
I mean, right away, too, they said Washington could use him. They said, too, that if Philadelphia and Dallas don't do very well, too, that, I mean, you know, they could be, you know, salivating over this guy, too. You know,
I had Cowboys fans at work telling me, like, if we lose in the first round, we should go for Belichick. I was like, wow, y'all really ready to go? All the sports
talk were saying, like, they're saying Philadelphia, they're saying, actually, Sam, some teams were saying that they better watch it if they don't make, certain teams don't make it out of the first round. Because they're like, Belichick's available. And wow. If you don't do this, get out of the first round. Like, people are like, they're going to go after Belichick. So
that's crazy. I wonder if the man still wants to coach. I agree with you. I'd ride off into the sunset, you know, getting to say a successful storied career at New England.
What is it? 24 season, I think I read. 9 Super Bowl appearances, 6 Super Bowls. I was like, fuck.
Yeah, and don't forget 8 rings because 2 as defensive coordinator. But, I mean, with...
For his run, though, as New England coach, this span, this great span of almost of 2 decades, I was like,
absolutely.
When you make 9 Super Bowl appearances.
Oh, yeah.
And he went 6.
I mean, fucking insane. You've done it all. Yeah. I mean, and again, I mean, I would definitely count those other two that, you know, a total of the guy, like, man's got 8 rings. Hell, yeah. You know?
This might have more. He's got 2 with the Giants and, you know, all that shit. And
this Facebook user says, love y'all. We love you too. We appreciate hearing that kind of comment.
Yeah, leave that to you.
We want to hear. Thank you. No doubt. But yeah, obviously you guys know I'm a Patriots fan, and I think Belichick
now
is a great coach.
Now
this is going to
be a hard part for sure now. Now, you know, it was kind of like, okay, Brady's gone, but, you know, Belichick was still there. Now it's, okay, this is completely rebuilding.
Yeah.
Now I did hear they promoted a linebackers coach for in-house.
Yes, Gerard Mayo.
In-house. Yeah. So.
And I know his name, I think, from being when he played or whatever. But
yeah, he played under him. He became a coach under him. So
it's kind of funny because you would think of guys like, you know, Josh McDaniel and Matt Patricia, who had, you know, left the organization maybe. Yeah. On their own,
kinda
for sure.
It's kind of like what happened with Jimmy Johnson's with North Turner. And, you know, he didn't do very well. And that's the one that he managed the high power Dallas offense for 2003. And then Dave Weinstead was a defensive coach. And he went to coach Chicago and all these other teams. And he didn't have any success either, you know. And
that's the thing I say about team sports, right? Sometimes it's the right combination at the right time. Yes. You know what I mean? So,
yeah,
Joe was in the house. Says, what's up, boys?
Hey, what's up, Joe?
Happy New Year, brother.
Happy New Year, man.
Yeah, no, I totally hear you, man. Yeah. So very, very interesting on that.
But yeah, man, two huge fucking names. I mean, that's huge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the only name they need more is Pop.
Right.
If Pop decided, like, you know what, I'm retiring too, you know. So
I guess maybe the other big name out there.
There you go. We just talked about it. Joe's next comment. If McCartney.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo Concert in Kansas City, go Kevin! Or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
Bill,
I mean, I'd be curious to see what he could do.
Joe is a true fucking Cowboy fan.
Yeah. Obviously, you were posting in our group, the Friday Night Faithful, about the playoff updates.
Oh, yeah.
We want to talk about that. But maybe the other big name to mention coaching-wise, you know, Black Monday, obviously notorious, right, after the season ends, who get the firings. I know there were several, but maybe the other one that stood out, and I didn't make a slide for it, but, you know, Pete Carroll, the Seahawks, 14
and at first,
seasons.
Like, at first, I was thinking, because they're saying that he's being removed from head coach, but he's going to be another position. I was thinking, oh, okay, maybe he's, you know, because he's already up there too in age. I was thinking, maybe he wants to just... you know, stop with the coaching, being like an advisor. But then it was like kind of news started coming out like later in the week saying that he was kind of removed by the team. It wasn't like a mutual decision. I was kind of like, ooh,
yeah.
Okay, which I don't understand. He did very well. You know, they got rid of Russell Wilson. They thought Seattle was going to tank. They made the playoffs after Russell, and then he almost made it this year. So I really don't understand that decision.
Joe brings up that it happened with Parcells. After the Giants, was that what we're referring to? Or when he was with, because he went to Dallas. Did he go to Dallas?
He did too, but I mean, like, he rebuilt Dallas.
Yeah,
I think he just went Oh, he didn't like working with Jerry Jones.
Oh.
He was like, Jerry Jones gave him complete control like the first year, and then like as the seasons were going by, Jerry Jones just wanted to stick his nose in. So that's when Parcells was like,
Joe reminds us Mike Vrabel too, I guess part of the firing.
I was really surprised about that one too.
From
he used to play with your guys, with you guys, mm-hmm. and then he coached Tennessee and he had a pretty good run.
Oh, right, younger guy. Yeah. I thought he had some good success.
Yeah.
In fact, didn't he beat Belichick in that Brady's like last season with the Patriots?
He even did one of Belichick's plays or whatever.
Yeah,
you know.
So that's like I thought he was doing well. I'm sure that he'll be a good pickup. Obviously, I think Rivera out at Washington.
Everyone saw that one coming.
For sure. I mean, Commanders aren't getting it going, so what are you going to do?
But you know what, man? Finally, they're under a new regime, and maybe they can reclaim that past glory, because, man, Washington, for at one time, that used to be one of the hardest tickets to get in the NFL, see, during the 80s. Like, you were on a wait list for, like, years to get season tickets for Washington, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so hopefully, you know, I don't like them. Don't get me wrong. I don't like the team, but I like to see the NFC East doing well.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, so. Absolutely. And also, too, you want, you know, good matchups and good, you know, good, obviously, games to come out of it. So, new Facebook, YouTube watcher, Mojo Potato, I love that name, by the way, says, unfortunately, I'm a Chargers fan. He says, you think they should go for Bill, Pete, or Harbaugh?
I think you guys should go for Harbaugh. Harbaugh is a really good coach. He's still young. Look what he did with San Francisco. He turned that fucking franchise around and made them Super Bowl winners.
Yeah.
He made Alex Smith look like $1 million.
I mean, there's a lot of, I think, opportunity there for the Chargers to
Bill,
do more things.
Bill Parcells, I don't know. I mean, not Bill Park. Bill Belichick.
Bill Belichick. Yeah.
And Pete Carroll. I don't know. Maybe Pete, too.
He's already on the West Coast, right? I mean, like, I figure this. It's nice in San Diego. Good weather.
Harbaugh has to be a pickup for any fucking team that you will
want. Plus, if you want to get some years out of them, too. I mean, like, you know, like we said, Belichick and Carroll kind of old.
So they're already kind of up there.
How much more are you going to get out of them? But, yeah, I think Harbaugh, I think a double A is right. Harbaugh would be
he just won a national championship, too, so.
Good comment, Mojo Potato. I like it. Joe says, could see one of them go to Atlanta. They got a good young
Joe,
team.
That's what everyone was saying, too, that Bill Belichick, if he does have a team, that he should go to Atlanta if he does coach another team.
And regarding the Chargers, Joe says, I think Pete's too old.
But see, Joe, Pete and Belichick, I don't think they're that far away in age.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Interesting. But like I said, guys, if you haven't checked out our group, please go check it out. Become a member of Mojo Potato if you're not already there. The Friday Night Faithful on Facebook. Join the group. Hear the conversation all playoff weekend long. AA was posting up great posts about the winners and the losers and that. And so we have a bracket now, guys.
People can't, like, you know... Sometimes they're like, oh, shit, who won?
Right. Well, yeah, you can go to our group and definitely check it out. And, of course, now everything's, like, all separate. Some things are on Prime. Some things are on, NBC. Some things are like, I long for the day when I could just flip around and see all the playoff games, on 13, on 4, on 5.
It's a real
Those used to be the channels, right, AA? I mean, like, you know, if you're in San Antonio, Texas, where we are, you know, 4, 5, and 13, you were always going to catch football. But this is what we got looking at this weekend, right, AA?
Yeah, so we got Cleveland-Houston. That's going to be the first game being played this weekend, followed by KC and Miami.
So let's break it down. Let's talk here, AA, about this, all right? Because I know everybody's going to want to know, and I want to hear all of you guys out there, your picks as well. I know not everyone's a football fan, but I'm very curious to hear what we think. So obviously, the number one seed in the AFC, the Ravens, our friend CJ Belanger up in Canada, his team, which I
like
know.
Baltimore. I really do. That's a damn good franchise.
Lamar is badass, what I mean? So, Ravens, obviously, have become a storied franchise, so, curious about them as well, but they are definitely not, my pick on who I want to see go out of the AFC. But let's talk about that first game, Browns and Texans.
Well, Texans on this one.
I mean, a lot of people have already been talking about potential for an all-Texas Super Bowl. I mean, the dream, right?
Yeah, that's
Houston crazy. Texans, Dallas Cowboys. I mean, it could be. I mean, as a Texan, there's something exciting about that.
You see, when that happened, though, back in 92, it was exciting because Houston was a strong offense. This one, I don't know.
Yeah.
And you know what? I want Cleveland to kind of regain its glory. Cleveland used to be one of those Hall of Fame franchises.
Absolutely.
And then they broke off and became Baltimore.
Yeah.
And Baltimore has enjoyed the successes that Cleveland should have had. So that kind of sucks. So, and you know what? Good for Flacco, man. That's
I was
going to
say, it's been a little bit of a comeback story for him. He's having his own
look
like
cut
a...
cut by New York. They said all he was doing was just sitting on the couch. And then Cleveland comes calling. You know,
people forget this guy won a Super Bowl with the Ravens. Super Bowl. You know what I mean?
So, he knows how to play against the AFC teams.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah. So, that's a tough one for me. I really like the Browns. Again, I've always said I'm like a closet, like, dark horse Browns fan. Because, you know, they're such an underdog. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Texans is, you know, Texas. You know what I mean? So, interesting there, a matchup. But your pick, Double A, Cleveland.
Cleveland.
I'll go Cleveland as well in this one. Miami, KC. You know, let's hop to the NFC side.
Real quick, I am excited about that one because apparently tomorrow is going to be 0 degree weather. So.
Yes. I have a coworker, a good friend, Colton, that is actually going out to KC to visit this weekend. He said he wasn't aware when they planned this weekend, but he said they're looking when he lands to have a temperature of 1.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's insane.
Yeah.
Real quick, let's get to some comments here.
Collector Joey.
Collector Joey says, yeah, Cowboys winning it all. Double A is a Cowboys fan, as is Joe right here, who says, yeah, the Peacock game is streaming exclusively.
That sucks. Tomorrow's both games are going to be on Peacock.
Okay. Mojo Potato says,
I was just having this argument today with my buddy. He goes, when did the NFL start doing Monday night playoff games? Isn't the winner at a disadvantage with a shorter week? I agree, too. I think the NFL is just fucking trying to make money, but it is at a disadvantage to the winner. That's bullshit. They shouldn't have to play Monday night
games. Less rest.
Yes.
Yeah, very interesting. That's I don't think I was even aware of that.
Yeah, so that's bullshit. So I feel bad for the Eagles or Tampa, whoever comes out of that one, because they're going to have a shorter week than everybody else.
To answer Mojo Potato's question, though, do you remember when they started at AA?
I think it was like a year or two, pretty recent.
Ugh, yeah, that's rough, man. They got to be a little bit more considerate of the guys that are out there on the field. Joe then says CJ's team is the Toronto Argonauts.
Wow. Right,
interesting. And Joe says Browns win, defense is too good.
I think so
good.
Too, Joe. And Cleveland's pumped.
They're riding that high, man, so for sure. Then Joe says,
crazy, it's Flacco's first time throwing over 300 yards, 3 games in
that's pretty cool.
He's on a roll, man.
Yeah, guys are rolling. And sometimes that momentum going in the playoffs is exactly what you want.
Yep.
You know,
the guys are pumped up on the team, the receivers are pumped up, the defense is pumped up.
And I'm sure the city's pumped up too. So tomorrow they're in Houston though, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I believe so.
So right up the road here. Corey in the house says, hey guys, what's up, Corey? Appreciate you being in the house, man. It's been a while. Corey says, Cowboys going to lose to Green Bay again. Oof, man. Tough comments there from Corey.
Okay, now you want to jump to
the NFC. Let's hop to the NFC side. The first game there is Tampa Bay and Philadelphia.
No, that's going to be the Monday night game.
Okay.
The first game's going to be, I believe, Detroit and the Rams.
All right. I'm going to go Rams because I hate the Lions.
I was going to say, but my friend says that I wasn't really paying attention, but he was saying the Rams started getting healthy late in the season, and he's like, right now, he goes, you better watch out for the Rams out of all these teams.
Yeah.
Because the Rams are healthy, and they're starting to beat teams. They were starting to beat teams late in the season.
Yeah.
It's going to be interesting because the Rams are, you know, it's Stanford. He's coming back.
Yes.
To Detroit. Mm-hmm. Goff is playing against St. Louis or Los Angeles, his old team.
Right.
So you got that narrative. You got Detroit that's, you know, won a division first time in 30 years in the playoffs. They're fucking pumped up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Rams, they're Super Bowl champs, you know? I mean, so, you know, they got to kind of, you know, they entered a wild, you know, as one of the weaker teams entering in. So
you're expecting a good game out of that one.
Yeah, I'm going to go Detroit, though.
I
think Goff's going to be kind of pissed off.
Yeah.
By the Rams.
And want some revenge.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you see the Lions going deep, though?
No.
Yeah, I was going to say. There's a lot of stiff, tough competition on the NFC side for sure.
Joe says, damn, I think Detroit wins, but rooting for the Rams.
There you go. I'm with you on that one, too, Joe. I think that the betting man in me would probably bet Detroit, but rooting for the Rams as well.
But like I said, my friend, he's really deep into ours. He says, do not sleep on the Rams.
There you go.
Because you wouldn't be surprised if the Rams make it pretty deep.
And that's a key, too, right? Sometimes you have a lot of injuries. You're losing games early in the season, but then you get healthy.
You get healthy.
And that, we all know that's the key, right? What were they talking about, like, it wasn't that long ago that it was like 6 starters or quarterbacks were like all out or whatever. So it was like
Mike Tomlin.
Dude, that's
Mike
tough.
Tomlin got the Steelers in by playing 4 different quarterbacks this season, and he still fucking made it in. So
that's insane. Health is wealth, truly, especially in the NFL. What's the other game tomorrow? Double A.
It's the 2 AFC. So it's gonna be Miami and KC. That's gonna be the other one.
This is gonna be a good game. I mean, I think
you know, I. I didn't know the weather too was gonna be bad.
Yeah,
because like my pick's Miami.
Mm.
But I was like, fuck, I don't know how they're gonna do in zero weather.
I mean, that, and you know what? That is such a factor that it could go either way, right?
Really,
like they're gonna be at KC though, right?
Yeah, and they're saying as the day goes on that it's just only gonna get colder. It might go into the negative.
Yeah,
so I was like,
you could say that KC is more equipped to play in that weather. You know, obviously Miami.
I don't think they've played in. I mean, I don't think they played that.
Yeah,
low,
I mean, everything changes, right? The ground is harder. The ball is harder. Slippery. We've seen all kinds of crazy shit happen in crazy weather. So that's an insane X factor.
I'm still going to go Miami. I'm still going to take my pick. I'm going to say Miami. Tua looks fucking awesome.
Tua has been great.
Casey hasn't been looking that well, so I'm going to go Miami.
Yeah. Although they didn't look great against the Bills.
No, they didn't.
They did not. No, so that's not. But that could be
again, the weather has to be an equalizer in this game. I would say that weather has to affect both teams.
Yeah. I'm picking KC. You know, that the Dolphins are
Joe says Miami KC. I think Miami should win, but KC might have weather advantage. But yeah, I don't know, Joe. I don't know. Weather could go both ways. It could be a fucking running game. Yeah. By both teams, you know? I mean, who knows?
Interesting. I mean, yeah, you want to try to keep the ball on the ground, but it may be the one that takes the risk.
You know, it's still going to be slippery for the opposing team as it is for a home team.
I think that Tua and Mahomes is a good matchup, though. It's going to, I think it could be an exciting football game.
Tua has been great. He's been healthy and good. He's been fucking great. So,
and let's not forget that fucking Mahomes' receivers have been kind of shitty. So it's like, fuck. And then bad weather? It's so very interesting.
Yeah. Corey's going with his Super Bowl pick. He's saying Baltimore and Detroit, with Baltimore taking it all.
Oh, wow. All right. Interesting pick there for getting it all there, Corey. The Ravens. They've done it before, so no reason they couldn't do it again, no doubt. Our good friend 14 Wellington in the house, he says, hey, all, how you doing? 14, appreciate you being in the house, brother. And then Mojo Potato Back says, team with the better defense and run game will do good in those cold weather games. Yep. That's not a bad assessment at all, for sure. Corey says, switched over to YouTube. Because every time I start commenting, FB freezes on the podcast. Dang, that's not no good. But we're happy to have you via YouTube as well, Corey. So welcome back again.
Yeah, so those two are going to be on for Saturday, tomorrow.
Okay. What are our Sunday games?
And so the Sunday's game, the first one's going to be Buffalo and Pittsburgh.
Okay.
And then you're going to go Cowboys, Green Bay.
Okay.
And then closing out Sunday is going to be the Rams and Detroit.
And I know it's MLK weekend, and, you know, obviously Monday has a very special meaning, and we shouldn't think of it this way, but badass that we get playoff football, and we don't have to, like, we can enjoy it because we're off Monday. Yeah. Well, some of us, I know.
No, but I mean, that's true, you know?
Yeah.
You know,
so, yeah, I mean, I know a lot of people, majority of Americans are off.
Oh, and man, so, you know, people are going to party tomorrow. Oh, yeah. With the Cowboy game during the afternoon.
Plus, a bunch of, this might be the most, like, fun and exciting games right now, because it's going to be fewer games next week, and we won't be off Monday, you know what I mean? So, okay, so let's go to that first game, AA.
Okay, so the first one's going to be Buffalo. Pittsburgh and Buffalo, man. Two legendary franchises.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Buffalo kind of got in there kind of at the last second, but man, Pittsburgh really squeezed the fuck in there. Like, they had to have help up the ass to make it to the playoffs. Tommy has done a good job, but I think getting into the playoffs is as far as he's going to get. I'm going to go Buffalo on this one.
Yeah, I'm going Buffalo on that one all the way to it's Josh Allen, right? I don't know why I always want to say Jared Allen, though, but I always want to say Josh Allen. Who the fuck is Jared Allen? Is that anybody? Yeah, I don't know why. I always want to say that. I think I knew a Jared Allen, maybe. But anyway, Josh Allen looked really good against the Dolphins. I watched most of that game. I was enjoying it. You know, I just really like that guy. Should I wish he was at New England with Belichick? Josh Allen, yeah. Unfortunately not, though, you know what I mean? But, you know, again, the Bills were my first football team, so, you know, always, you know, quietly rooting for them, and I think that franchise is storied.
It's awesome to look at, you know, the AFC side. You have Cleveland back, Miami back, Buffalo back, Pittsburgh in there, you know, so.
It's like old school, right? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I definitely pull it for Buffalo on that one, and also I do think they're the better pick for the
Joe week. Thinks in the Pittsburgh-Buffalo game, he's going Buffalo wins easy.
Mm.
Joe says, let's go Cowboys. I think the defense gets to Love. Man, I don't know, Joe. Love looked really good on that last game. Corey says Buffalo going to beat Pittsburgh, so okay. Corey's going Buffalo.
Seems like we're all unanimous on that one.
Joe says Jared Allen was a
defensive end for Minnesota back in the day. Okay, all right.
And then Mojo comes in too, same thing.
There he goes, Jared. There. All right, thank you guys. Appreciate you guys. The laughing.
So pretty much everyone's almost in agreement. Buffalo
sounds like the odds on pick for that one. Okay, so let's hop over now.
Middle game is going to be the Green Bay Dallas game.
This one, I think, is tough. You know what I mean? Like, obviously, you guys know I'm not a Cowboys fan, but I love AA. But I'm also not a Packers fan by any means at all. So, yeah. So, and our good friend, we call him Invitation Adam, our friend Adam. Yeah. Adam, also up in
Leander,
Texas. Mr. Green Bay, huge Green Bay fan. Been to Green Bay, been to Lambeau, but no love for them, no love for the Packers. From us to him, but he's gonna definitely be, like he said, it's gonna be you and him talking shit that day to each other. What do you think, Double A? You think your guys got a good
Cowboys
chance?
Are gonna do it because you know they don't have Rodgers. I did see Love and everyone on the radio saying that Green Bay's probably made it into the playoffs a lot earlier probably than they thought. And Jared Love's good. Mm-hmm. That guy is good, but I'm gonna say the defense is gonna be too strong for this Green Bay team. I'm gonna say Dallas takes it.
Okay. I really am torn because I really don't know. I feel like these guys are kind of evenly matched. I think it's going to be a good game. But they're playing where?
Dallas.
At Dallas?
Yeah.
I don't know. This might
Dallas
be like
are
a
strong at home for whatever reason. That's, really
that's right. In
home.
Fact, they have not. Have they lost?
I don't think they've
lost at home. Yeah. You know what? It pains me to do it, but I might have to pick the Cowboys on this one, guys.
And Corey says, so Green Bay has Dallas number the last two playoff games. But again, Corey, that was with Aaron Rodgers, which they left 2 minutes on the clock for that guy.
Yeah.
And 2 minutes for Aaron Rodgers is too damn long. You might as well just give him a whole quarter.
I just watched the highlights from that game, and I just saw how that, which, I mean, maybe you could say it was a prime Rodgers, like, tore them up or whatever. Like, I was like, fuck. Yeah. Like,
now,
that
Love,
was very
I don't think
dangerous.
Love is Aaron Rodgers level yet.
Right.
You know,
no.
So.
No, not at all. Yeah. And I would say you guys have a better defense this year, too,
The defense
is
a lot better.
That is going to be what
Parsons
what
is
going to
be fucking pumped up.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Joe then says,
he's going to the Philly Bucks. He goes, I would really say Philly goes over this game, but this game can go either way.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you guys right now my pick on that game. I'm going all the way for the Bucks because I loathe the Eagles. So,
I don't like
you
the
know
Eagles
me?
Either.
But, and also they've got, it's Baker over there, right?
Yeah,
Baker Mayfield.
So, and the thing, too, we'll get to that game in a minute.
Okay,
Corey
let's
goes,
finish up. Corey says,
this is going to come to who makes the most
It could
mistakes.
Be. Yeah, that's absolutely right.
Joe says, you're crazy saying it's evenly matched. and Joe says this totally new Green Bay team. They're good but too young. And then Corey says Dak is overrated being carried by Lamb, so it depends how Green Bay covers Lamb.
All right, see there you go. There.
But and then, so far, you know, no one has really covered Lamb. Lamb broke the single season record for Dallas. He had 1,700 yards this season.
And again, if the Green Bay defense tries to focus on the problem of Lamb, that potentially, if Dak is smart and the offensive adjusts, that leaves people open. That leaves other opportunities. It's all about, that's always how you play it.
That CeeDee knows how to get open.
Exactly.
That's
the thing, and he fucking burns guys out there when they're out in the field. So that's, you know, I don't know. I'm saying Joe, youth and exuberance on the Green Bay side, you know, could play a factor or whatever, but I'm picking you guys. So, but yeah.
Okay. And then the next game is going to be Monday night. It's going to be Philly and Tampa Bay, which again, man, you know, I thought Philly was going to be my team representing the NFC, but
they started shooting the bed late in the season.
Yeah,
right?
Bad, man. And right now, I don't know, Tampa Bay, but Baker Mayfield, you know, that dude is never short on confidence. You know, I mean, Baker Mayfield loves playing in these situations. And
absolutely.
He's got tempo rolling. So.
Absolutely. I would love to see the Eagles go out in the
Philly.
First round.
I'm still
going to
say Philly.
I think they probably are the better team, but I would like to see them, just that fan base, get shut down, and especially by Baker Mayfield and the Bucks. Again, if I was a betting man, I don't know that I would bet on the Bucks. You know what I mean? But it's tough to say, but I'm picking the Bucks for sure for me on that. I think that's a more exciting end result to that game. Corey also says going Tampa Bay. He says Philly got cold. Absolutely. And that's, again, the same way that you ride, you know, youth and energy and exuberance into the playoffs with the wins. Sometimes you are on that cold streak and you can't get out of it.
But you know, who knows? Maybe Jalen Hurts comes back out and
that's true.
Blows everybody away.
That's true. Could be that the playoff energy turns on. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, you're getting hyped up. You know that it's win or go home.
He was at the Super Bowl last year.
Yep.
You know, so he wants to go back.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So anything can happen. So good conversation. Good stuff on that, guys. You know, again, we don't cover a lot of sports here on Just Another Friday Night, but we do love sports and we'll be watching the games tomorrow. I'm excited to be watching the games with AA tomorrow and just chilling out. And enjoying probably some junk food and just good football. So we'll see what happens. We'll see next week's show who was right on these picks. We'll talk about that. And then we'll have another bracket by then, and we'll talk about that next week. So I love that. I wanted to put this up because you were talking so much. You had posted so many picks of the winners and losers in our group, so I want to talk about that. But mainly what we do here on Just Another Friday Night, guys, is we do talk about the world of pop culture. And when we say that, you know, sports is popular culture as well. But we mainly think about things like movies and TV and comic books and, you know, things of that nature. So the big news that Marvel has stuff out. Obviously, we're talking about one of the things tonight. But one of the big ones that arrived just a few days ago, right, AA, was?
Yeah. Echo. Yeah, which I forgot about until you told me that it came out.
And they did this one different, where they were like, we're going to drop all five episodes at once. It premiered on the 9th, I believe, January 9th. I don't know what day that was. Yeah, it was a Wednesday, I think. Yeah, and they were like,
they're still sticking on the Wednesday, so.
Right, but they just, no, the 9th was a Tuesday, yeah. Tuesday. And then they put, I think that was right, or it could have been the 5th. I'm not sure when it what day it premiered, but they dropped them all at once. Obviously, we're bringing back the character of Maya, for the last name, it's Maya, but it's her first name, but I guess she becomes like Echo, she first came out in the Hawkeye show. That's where we first saw her, introduced her.
I was trying to tell my friends, I was like, I think it was Hawkeye, because I think that's where Kingpin came in.
Yeah, Lopez. Maya Lopez, sorry. Okay. Yes, yeah, she debuts in Hawkeye. She's kind of like one of Kingpin's, you know, assassins. Her dad also appears in that show. We get some of her backstory there. Her dad is killed by Ronan, who is Hawkeye. But, you know, obviously he was in the criminal underworld, you know, with Kingpin's guys. Her dad was played by, our actor that we like from Res Dog, the Light Horseman. I forget what his name is. Let me look him up real quick. But he's also in Dr. Sleep. I love him in that. He's just a really great actor, you know, all around.
I really wish Punisher would have killed her dad. So then Punisher would have just killed her. Yeah.
Damn, Double A, you saw
after Hawkeye, which Hawkeye's not going to finish the job.
Yeah.
You know, why don't you try that shit on Punisher?
You sound like when I'm watching stuff with CM Cal now. He's always like, man, I really wish Omni-Man would just swoop down and, like, you know, kill Rick Splode.
Because it's so funny, right? Like, if you really put all these dudes, right, like, in the path of the Punisher, I'm pretty damn sure Punisher is going to blow their head off.
Yeah. Zan McLarnon is his name. He plays
from Red Sox.
This guy.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, from Dr. Sleep.
Yes, from Dr. Sleep. Yeah, okay. But I forget what his name is in Res Dog.
And I forgot his fucking name too.
And I know, obviously, we covered that show. We should fucking know that. Let me look it up real quick right here, because I just love that guy. He's such a great actor. He's
fucking funny, Res Dog.
Yeah, he's hilarious. Big. Yeah, he's big. That's right. Duh.
No, the stupidest name, right?
Yeah, the dumbest name.
It's just Big.
And quick comments here. No spoilers, hopefully, Corey. He says, totally disappointed with that show. He said, Putting it
just above Shield.
Oh, okay. Wow. All right.
And he said spoiler, what you just said. Kingpin killed her dad. Yeah. No. Right. It's pretty much what you said.
Oh, right.
Kingpin killed her dad, but Ronan told her.
Yes. And that was in the Hawkeye show, so that which we
and
we
then right above Corey, Joel did ask, y'all getting ready for the winter storm?
Yeah. I mean, that's a Sunday night it's hitting, right?
I got to work in it, Joe. So, yeah, I'm not really ready.
Well, everyone, wish AA safety out there when he's working out on the roads.
It's just, it sucks.
Yeah, it definitely sucks. I've watched a few episodes of this. I know my nephew wanted to watch it too because he wanted to see the Kingpin. So we watched, I think we're three episodes in. Okay. Me and him. He's not as entranced by it as I thought.
I wouldn't think so, Sam.
Yeah.
This doesn't look like something he'd be into.
Yeah. But what I have enjoyed, AA, is a lot of Res Dog's cast is there. For
sure. But man, you know, if he had told me that, like, he had said, hey, you know, what do you think? Should I check out the show Echo? I probably would have told him. I don't know. It's not Guardians. You know what I mean? Right. It's not Avengers. It's not Guardians. You know, so it's gonna be kind of hard.
Excuse me, guys. Yeah, and we just watched. I'm trying to think what we just had watched together. I don't know, but I know you had got me watching AA Twisted Metal. And I have loved it. I have loved it. And I told him, I was like, I want to show you this. I think that he'll enjoy it. I know it's probably not appropriate for a 10-year-old, but it's definitely fun show.
Yeah.
And I think that it's up his alley, being the kind of things we've been watching more recently together.
It's entertaining.
You know, especially since he loved Invincible, things like that. More comments. Okay.
Just read jokes.
Joe says here, I watched a few to get ready for today. Okay, great. Regarding what we talked about today.
Echo? We're not talking about
Echo. We're not talking Echo today, Joe, but yeah.
Or are you talking about just go down, Corey.
Okay, let me see what Corey says here. If you have to watch it for upcoming movies, but don't get your hopes up on it. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, but we're just talking right now, guys, about the news that came out regarding the big news that came out from Marvel and things that came out this week. So obviously Echo was one of those things that came out, one of them that we're talking about. But the other one that we're getting really excited for on Max from HBO coming out is
Sunday
night, True Detective Night Country, starring Jodie Foster.
It's gonna be cold here. It's gonna be cold on the show.
Yeah, man, I'm telling you. If you guys have not seen any True Detective, highly recommend season one. Cannot recommend it enough. My sister watched it. She loved it. Yeah. And me, her, and Jess watched season three all together at the same time. They saw me watching it. They watched it. They loved season three. Mm-hmm. Season two is...
season two is trash. Let's just be honest about it.
Season you can skip season two.
And season two was badly miscast.
Right. Yeah. And they're all... You know what? I wouldn't even say that the cast was bad, Double A. I thought it was a good
cast. They were in wrong roles.
It was... Maybe
Vince
so.
Vince Vaughn was not good in that role. Colin Farrell was not good. Well, he was funny in that role.
I thought the story was bad.
Was not good in her role.
But I just felt like that the story was convoluted and I didn't know what was going on. And it was like, it was, yeah, place. You don't have to watch season two. They're all different. They're all different casts, but season one, Woody Harrelson and, Matthew McConaughey, excellent, really great, minor role by, Alexandra Daddario. If you're a fan of her, you will enjoy her, I will say bit part in that, yeah, and then season three, you've got Mahershala Ali and Stephen Dorff, and it's also fantastic. So you cannot get enough of season one, season three, and this one looks really good. We're hoping it lives up to season one and season
three. I think
it
will. I don't think Jodie Foster is just going to come along and say, you know, yeah, I'll just do this for the money. Yeah. Fuck it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And Jodie Foster, probably, I'm going to go ahead and say she's probably my favorite actress of all time.
So. That's a great pick. Yeah, that's a great pick.
I love her movies. I love her acting.
Yeah.
She's just great.
I don't know that I've seen enough of her work to say she'd be one of my favorites. Because there's always, with actresses, it's hard for me because I feel like they have probably a larger body of work and I haven't seen enough of it. You know what I mean? But, I could definitely see Jodie Foster being a great pick.
I mean, even if you didn't know, I mean, everyone should know Silence.
Oh, yeah.
How great absolutely. She was in that one and how much she was missed in Hannibal.
Yeah.
You know? So.
And I still do love Hannibal, though.
Joe says... You can tell she was missed big time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Joe says, new Curb Your Enthusiasm coming as
you
well.
You into that one?
I do like that show. I'm not kept up with it, but okay. I can pop it on, and it is very Seinfeld-esque, so you could definitely get, you know, or Seinfeld-ish. You could definitely get a lot of those vibes out of that show, and it's hilarious. Joe says, Alexandra Daddario, that wasn't a small part. they weren't small parts. He says, Jodie doesn't do anything bad.
I love her in True. I mean, I love her in Silence. I love her in Taxi Driver. I love her in Little Man Tate. I love her in The Brave One.
See, those two I
love her
seen.
In Maverick. You know, she's fucking funny.
Love her in
Maverick.
Yeah.
You know?
No, I never seen No.
I love her in A Quiet Place. She fucking kills it in not A Quiet Place. The Panic Room.
Oh, yeah. Love great in Panic Room. Yeah. Have you seen No?
I saw a little bit. She's all right in that one.
I know the other one that people talk about too is The Accused.
I'm not going to watch that one. I'm not going to. I don't like seeing rapes and anymore. Okay. That's what that one is.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I don't like seeing that.
Yeah. I hear she's great in it though, but yeah.
Yeah. Her and Kelly McGinnis, they just said they're both really great in that movie.
Really? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'm interested to maybe potentially see it.
And then she did the first Freaky Friday, I believe.
Is
the one that
right?
She did. And then they did kind of like a horror one with Vince Vaughn.
Okay. I think I remember
that first
one. Joe says Panic Room, very underrated.
That's a great movie, right, Joe? Fuck, Panic Room is really
Panic
good.
Room is good with Dwight Yoakam in there.
Dwight Yoakam, Forrest Whitaker, Jared Leto, Kristen Stewart.
Yeah, good cast, man. Good cast.
Inside Man. She was good in Inside Man. That's quite
a
movie.
Great in Inside Man. Forgot about her in that too. Yeah, she's a real tough cookie in that one. Yeah. She's like the. Kind of like the behind the scenes type.
Yeah.
Like
I'm telling you, man,
running
Jodie
business.
Foster kills it. Sure.
Yeah, she's really great. What else, Double A? I know that we had some news that I didn't make a slide
I guess
for.
The big Star Wars news, right?
Oh, right. Mandalorian and Grogu. Totally forgot to do a slide for that.
It's like, man, wow, they're actually going to go forward with that.
And they're saying no season four, going straight to the movies. And they're going to call it, I think, that Mandalorian and Grogu. Yeah. I don't think it's a great title, but you know what I mean? Like, okay.
Who knows? Lone Wolf and Cub, right?
Yeah, all right. Oh, well, okay. Now you put it down. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. I mean, I'm pumped for it.
I'm up for it, man.
Everyone I've been hearing say they didn't like season three has a lot to live up to the movie.
Which is crazy. I don't understand why season three was hated so
much. Yeah, it was fucking cool.
It was great. I love that shit. Joe says Equalizer 3 came out on Netflix. It was really good.
Yes, I watched it too,
I thought your comment saying that he should be right up there with John Wick.
I think that he should be, man. Fucking killer assassin. So. McCall, Robert McCall, man. Have you watched those movies?
No, I
Oh, man.
I'm embarrassed to say I haven't.
Don't be.
I'm a huge Denzel fan.
Yeah.
You know, I just haven't seen
those three. They will not do you wrong.
I know.
All three of them. Like, I was watching with Jess. She was like, this movie was fucking badass. I was like, yeah, it was badass. It's like those Hemsworth ones, the ones that he's got on Netflix too.
Extraction.
Phew. Those shits are badass, dude. I was like, damn. It's movies like that that remind me of like when we would watch old school action back in the day, like 80s action. The Seagal movies, y'all just right? Or when we were like the Van Damme shit, the Schwarzenegger shit.
I'd say the Seagal ones are probably more in line with like these kind, where Seagal just goes balls out.
The cool thing I will say about these Equalizer movies is that, and my dad said it's based on an old show, an old 70s show.
Yes. Do you remember that little part in Wolf of Wall Street where he's talking about Rob Reiner, his dad, and he's taking the call? He's like, yeah, he would always try to tell people not to call him during the Equalizer.
I remember that.
So pissed, he'd be like, oh, fuck, who the fuck is calling me? Blah, blah. And then he would get on the phone and he goes, and for some reason, he would always answer with an English accent. And he would talk like English and then he hang on the phone and like, fuck. What happened? And the wife's trying to tell him. He's like, what guy? Who?
You know,
like,
I don't remember that
Yeah,
part.
So it's a small part of Wolf of Wall Street, but they're watching The Equalizer.
That's awesome. And
actually, see him, I think, help me his name, Johnny from Cobra Kai.
William Zabka.
I think he was the son of the character.
No shit.
In that show. I think he's in that
show. Okay,
like
as a kid.
Yeah, well, no, it's right after Cobra, Karate Kid.
Oh, it's so. After.
Yeah, I think
okay.
So
in the 80s. All right. Yeah, my dad was talking about, he's like, did you ever watch the show? And I was like, nah, dad, that's one I don't remember seeing. Yeah. But he loved all the, like, you know, my dad was always like Hawaii Five-0, Miami Vice, Magnum P.I. So
yeah,
when they make these movies, my dad's like, oh, I used to watch the movie. Like when we saw SWAT, he was like a big SWAT of the show SWAT, you know? But yes, Joe, great point. Those are excellent films. I will say this, and I might get fucking damned for this, but I feel like the stories are kind of better than the John Wick stories. Like the stories of the movie, whatever. He's more rooted in reality. Like I feel like John Wick, the first one is good, but then he starts to kind of be like supernatural, where I'm like, oh, he's
kinds
of shit.
The falls, the landing on metal beams, getting run over every fucking movie. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, these are a little bit more.
I like the first one the most still.
Yeah, me too.
To John Wick.
Yeah, and I haven't seen the fourth one still yet.
Like
I know.
I told you too. I love the Mission Impossible movies, but it's always the same shit.
Absolutely.
Somehow the government always thinks he's betraying them, even though he's.
Yeah.
That's like the same narrative too in every movie. It's like fuck what like I'm you know what I'm just retiring. Fuck you. You think I'm like. Fucking the rat around here.
Exactly.
You know,
like, I think we even said when we covered him, right? The only one that was like part two is where the only where he's
where he has the backing of the government. Yeah.
Good shit. Yeah. Joe says, good call on the 80s, 90s action flicks. Thank you, Joe. The other big news that you brought to me was Marvel has stated that
the Netflix Marvel shows.
The Netflix Marvel shows
are now canon. And that they did a timeline of where each of those takes place now.
I love that. I love that.
Finally, right? I mean, Marvel fucking let Netflix do it. They're like, yes, please make it. The Defenders takes place, during that whole time
They
period.
Talk about it. And I mean, they talk about the Battle of New York and all that, or whatever.
You see it in, like, Karen's office or something like that.
And it's kind of neat, though, that they did manage to keep it street level. So it wasn't like they necessarily were involved with all that. I mean, but... You know, you could easily have fucking Punisher shooting some Chitauri that are in, you know, New York, his part, and Daredevil beating some up that were in, you know, Hell's Kitchen or whatever, if you wanted to. But I like that they kind of kept it street. And I mean, like, I always felt like even though Netflix was doing those, you know, like, on the side, Kevin Feige still probably was, like, has last say, right?
Because even those follow such a great kind of, like, timeline where they mm-hmm. all stick with each other. You mm-hmm. know, where you have to see Jessica Jones, you had to see Luke Cage, you had to see Punisher.
Right.
You know, you had to see all of them.
Right.
In order to make the story cohesive. Remember I told you, it was kind of like, what was it? It was, you had to watch like season one and two, I think, of Jessica Jones, Luke Cage season one, Daredevil mm-hmm. season one and two, mm-hmm. to see the Defenders. So the Defenders will make sense, still make sense. And then you had to like watch the other seasons after you watch the Defenders.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was like Punisher, it really does help if you see Daredevil season two. Mm. So you can get a fleshing, a liking to John Bernthal's Punisher. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because those episodes
are really great with John Bernthal in Daredevil season two.
Oh, yeah.
Those episodes are really fucking good.
I cannot recommend enough those.
It really sets the pace mm-hmm. for Punisher season one and two.
No, totally. And I think that's a great move by them to just finally incorporate them. Obviously, they've been bringing back, you know, we've seen, you know, Matt Murdock. We've seen the Kingpin. You know, we've even seen Daredevil in the She-Hulk show.
Now, with this, hopefully they kind of still keep, you know, Mike Coulter and I forgot that just Kristen Stewart.
Kristen.
I forget
her name, too. Yeah.
But hopefully they keep him, you know, and John, you know, they already said John Bernthal for sure is coming back as.
That's Frank, great. So. Yeah, and we've already got, you know, Vincent D'Onofrio as Kingpin, and we've already got Charlie Cox as Matt Murdock. So that's great. I think that's awesome. And now we've
and then you know they had to have heard the response. You know, when Charlie Cox came out in Spider-Man.
Oh I yeah, mean,
that blew up in my theater.
Yeah,
when they showed Daredevil,
huge pop,
man.
Yeah,
that was one of the louder pops in the movie.
I will say this: the little bit that I've watched Echo with my nephew, one of the things he did say was he was like, "I'd like to see Daredevil now," and I was like, "I will happily sit through that with you again." So,
you think he'll enjoy those? Though,
honestly? Oh, I think so.
You don't think they're too gritty?
No, I think there's enough like action in them, and then like you know the thing about those is they didn't go too overboard. Like there's really no swearing. There's not like gratuitous sex in those. I mean, it's just really like action or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I think some of the story, you know, but I think he'll finally get it. Yeah, Joe, that's actually big news. I'm going to talk about that real quick.
Either that or change gears. He came out. Joe's saying he's coming out today, right now.
Well, I mean, I did see when he came out, what was it, last week, two weeks ago? When he dropped that little promo about, you know, where would he sit
at? Yeah, and then he came out last week and I guess beat Jinder Mahal.
Oh, poor Jinder Mahal. Comes back just to get beat up by The Rock. But I did like his little promo. I heard it saying that where would he sit? Would he sit at here or here? Would he sit at the head of the table? Pretty good little chide there at Roman Reigns. I guess not Cody or not Punk is going to dethrone Reigns, but The Rock.
But you know what? If they do it, doing it Rumble or Elimination Chamber?
Not at Mania?
Well, so I've heard some people say this, that he might cause Roman to lose at either Rumble or Elimination Chamber.
Okay.
Which will set up a match for them at Mania.
Okay. Okay. So have him drop the title first.
Yeah.
Not face The Rock for the title.
No.
Because that would be dumb.
That would be stupid.
Because Rock's obviously not going to be...
He's not going to be there.
...fighting for the belt.
And then, too, Rock really needs to get in shape.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about wrestling shape. Yeah. Because when he did do that promo, he was a little fucking winded.
Winded already.
Yeah.
Right.
So yeah. I was like, oof.
Yeah. You know? He can't be getting gassed in the promo.
And he's just getting older. I mean, that fight with Cena, those matches with Cena have to be 10 years ago already. So.
And we know that ring ready and like, you know,
looking
ring
ready
shape
or two and different wrestling ring shape is way different.
Yeah. Because I forgot who his last match was, and they said he was working out with somebody, and I was like, oh, that's a pretty good guy to work out with. But then I think we all had agreed, we're like, oh, he looked kind of like not himself, you know what I mean? Like, you know.
I can't remember.
Moving around the ring, I can't really remember either. Joe quickly coming back in and says, setting up Rock Roman for Mania, maybe Cody versus Orton for the title.
I mean, you really have to go Punk in the main event.
I feel like that too. You really want Punk in that main event?
Yeah, because like they blew it with Cody last year. Well, Cody was shit hot. They should have main evented Cody last year against Reigns.
Yeah.
And hopefully they don't blow it with Punk this year.
Yeah, I agree. If that's your thoughts, Joe, what do you have? Where do you have Punk at in the setup? Let us know. what else, Double A? Was there anything else that happened?
Rollins.
Punk Rollins. I don't know. Yeah, that's fine.
They keep teasing that, though.
Yeah, and they might be building to that. But hopefully they can resolve that before and then set up bigger matches for Mania. You know what I mean? So.
But that might be the big match, though. We might not think it's a big match, but...
That's true.
Yeah. That is a big match.
Yeah.
And that wouldn't be bad. I mean, shit. Cody Orton. Punk. Rollins, mm-hmm. and Reigns and Rock. That's not a bad fucking three.
Well, who do you have headline, though, night one, night two?
See, night one, I would give it to... Well, it depends, I guess, on Rock's schedule, but...
Yeah.
Maybe night two, I'd give Rock Reigns night two.
That's your second main event.
And I'd give Punk... Punk has a main event, the other one.
I mean, yeah, I would think so. Yeah, you're not going to put Cody Orton. Cody's been...
Yeah, and Orton, too. He's been in a few main events that we were like, wow, this is kind of boring.
Yeah. Just as Cody Orton have history. Yeah, the legacy history. Uh-huh. Yeah, no doubt. I don't know if it's enough to build on, but... Joe says Punk Rollins night one is how he would do it. No, it's not bad booking. Not bad booking, I think, on any of our parts. Those are
three strong matches, like, for the mm-hmm. first time in a long time, right, that you can say you have, like, yeah. three
I would
like,
have
really solid bouts.
Vested interest to watch those matches, you know what I mean? Like, so, for sure, like, if you were all hanging out watching, I would definitely want to see those, at least the night one, because it's a Saturday, not a Sunday. Yeah.
Which I have been doing lately. That's the one I get together just for the fuck of it. Just because
I think, I think last year I watched, ended up watching on Peacock.
Did you see it with Austin? Did you see it here with me?
I watched with you, okay. Yeah. But I think I watched night two, like either on Monday, like by myself. Yeah, like I just watched it, like, but I fast forwarded like a lot of the stuff I didn't want to see. Then I just watched like the main stuff. So it was pretty solid.
And then AJ too, he's good too. So who would you put AJ against? Because man, that's another good guy to have.
Seriously,
you still got Rhea Ripley. You still got all those other guys too.
And I feel like they would want to showcase the women, especially her. She's been doing really great.
Yeah, she's a fucking superstar, man.
Joe says Cody Orton and Rock Roman Knight too.
Man, you gotta have Dom.
You gotta have Dom. Joe says, shit, I'd be down for a wrestling hang. Yeah, Joe, we got to make that happen.
When it gets closer, Joe.
Absolutely, man.
I think that's in April.
I feel like you always do your own big thing, but yeah, I mean, yeah, let us know. Let's make that happen. At least a Saturday one. I didn't put anything up. I didn't do any slides, but the Emmys happened, right? And we got...
Shit, did they?
Yeah.
I saw the Golden Globes.
Golden Globes. I'm sorry. Oh, okay. I'm thinking about the Emmys. So the Golden Globes, right? Okay. Yeah, we saw Nick Offerman win for the last...
Yeah, man, everybody kind of blew up on our chat about him winning. Like a lot of the group members were like, you know, happy that he won.
Well, I love Nick Offerman from Parks and Rec, but obviously, you know, we covered The Last of Us.
That was a great episode. That was really an incredible episode.
It was an incredible acting job. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Especially because if you see him in Parks and Rec and you see him in this
way,
apart from each other.
Real quick, back to wrestling. Joe says, AJ going to go against LA Knight, it looks like. I don't
know. But LA Knight's big, though, right now.
I guess.
I know we personally don't, but man, that's a heavyweight matchup, though,
right? When somebody called him a glorified Mr. Kennedy, I was like, that's it. That's what he is.
But people are over with. He's over with people.
Keep telling me Gunther's over too, and I'm like, Gunther's over?
Kennedy fucking sucked. Kennedy was, man.
Look, Double A. I don't see people walking around with LA Knight shirts or Gunther shirts.
They're saying he's one of their top merch. Every time I'm reading reports, he's one of the main merch sellers.
Maybe I'm not in my.
Hey, look, AJ's at that position too, where he's probably like, you know, if you want him to go over, that's fine, you know. He said this was going to be his last contract anyways.
He's going to retire?
Yeah. He said he's good. He's done everything in TNA. He's done everything in WWE, in New Japan. He's like, he wants to spend time with his kids now.
So he doesn't want one last run.
No, he's like, he was good. Shit, they gave him a year. See him? They gave him a year with that belt.
All right. I guess. I don't know.
The man's happy. You know, and honestly, I've heard him in interviews where he's like, yeah, it's just a belt. You know, it's like... You know.
Well, yeah, I mean, I know it's more about having good matches, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but that's all he ever cared about. But he's like, I've had all the success, I've done it, you know, so.
I don't know, I feel like, I don't know, maybe that's just as a fan. I'd like to see him go against Punk.
Trust me, I would like to see that match, but I don't think he likes Punk.
Oh, really?
I think I've seen an interview, too, where he doesn't like Punk either. So.
Yeah, I mean, you know, put on a good show for the fans. Joe says Gunther Brock probably at Mania.
Man, I thought Brock beat his ass at Rumble, that last Rumble, remember?
Yeah. I think I did see that. Squash match?
I mean, no, they were in the Rumble together, and I think
he
just, like, beat him. beat him.
Interesting. Also, the young gal from The Last of Us won a Golden Globe. She was the love interest of... the gal.
Really? Bella Ramsey?
Not her, but the
other one?
The other one won. Yeah. I don't know if it was for supporting or what it was. Yeah, she won one. Paul Giamatti, I'm not sure what for.
Yeah, for the holdovers. If you have Peacock.
I haven't seen
that. That's a movie that's like on. It was at the theater, but it kind of went out.
What? Oh, it's no good?
it's one of those movies, I guess, where you just see it at home. It might be good. Paul Giamatti doesn't do bad stuff, but I was kind of hoping they were going to give it to someone else.
Yeah.
I was like, they should have given it to Timothy Chalamet.
Oh, okay.
Because he said this was the third one he's won.
Oh,
Giamatti.
Wow. I was like, Timothy Chalamet for what? Dune?
Wonka.
Oh, Wonka. All right.
Yeah, because everyone's loving that movie.
Yeah, no doubt. Joe says RDJ won.
So too,
I hope he gets Oscar. Yes, absolutely. I hope so too. He won for Oppenheimer.
He's been long overdue. Honestly, that guy. That guy is a real actor.
Yeah, I would love to see RDJ get an Oscar.
See, that'd his be movies awesome. In the '80s and nineties. That dude was like a real fucking hardcore actor.
And Oppenheimer swept a lot of stuff, right? That, you know, usually I think the Golden Globes like the setup
best
for the
picture, best director, best actor, best supporting actor.
So I think they always say the Golden Globe is like the precursor, to the Oscars. But Oscar Academy...
Yeah, because Mickey Rourke was winning all those fucking awards until he got to the Oscar and Sean Penn won.
And got fucked over there. Yeah. Randy the Ram still got an award in my book.
He sure did, man. They fucked him over.
What else, AA?
I feel like Blackstone won. That was cool.
And if you have Apple TV, that came out today on Apple TV, Killers of the Flower Moon, the new Martin Scorsese movie. I think some people were waiting. I was waiting. I'm not going to... I'll watch that probably like in the early morning by myself because I don't think anybody want to watch that with me. 3 hours, right, AA?
Yeah, so. But then, you know, if you're a Scorsese fan, that's kind of normal.
Yeah. and I love Lily Gladstone,
Last Temptation of Christ was a long movie. It was good.
The Irishman was also long. But Casino long, but good long. You know, so what else, AA? I feel like was there anything else that maybe came out or was getting talked about? There was one thing I had in my mind and I meant to write it down and I didn't that I was gonna tell you guys. I was thinking about it as I was coming over here. I was like, what was the other other news that would have been like worthy news, but it may come to me later. But yeah, we've been talking for about exactly an hour, guys. Our lead in to the show, talking news, talking things like that.
Oh, and real quick, I saw it on Tubi.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, the documentary on Joan Jett.
Tilt it back a little bit. There you go. Hey, there it is.
Bad Reputation.
Nice.
Damn good documentary.
You watched it on Tubi, but you picked it up also?
But I have it, yeah.
Oh, okay. Nice. So, yeah, How was it?
It was really good.
Really good?
Yeah.
So
check it out if you're a Joan Jett fan.
I watched a movie that was kind of psychological, and it got me interested to want to hear the book. I'm listening to the book on audio right now, but it's called, from 2011, We Need to Talk About Kevin. Have you heard about this movie?
No.
It's Tilda Swinton and John C. Reilly are the parents, and then the kid is Ezra Miller or whatever. He plays the kid or whatever, so. Yeah, them being a couple is kind of weird, whatever, but fucking bananas-ass story, AA, if you feel like a psychological type thriller, go ahead and give it a watch. It's fucking freaky, guys, but yeah. And I'm listening to the book and it's more detailed or whatever, obviously, as the books are, but yeah, we need to talk about Kevin if you just want something freaky to watch. Don't watch it with the kids.
Tilda Swinton usually does those kind of weird movies.
Yeah, like I was like, what is this? I had kind of like read a little bit about it and then I was like, oh, let's check it out. So Jess was like, that movie was fucked up. I was like, it was kind of fucked up. So something interesting if you get a chance to watch.
Yeah, real quick, on Netflix, I told CM about this. It's called Louder Milk.
Mm-hmm.
Check that one out. That one's pretty cool. That one's funny. Ron Livingston.
Yeah.
You guys know Office Space? The main actor from Office Space. He's fucking hilarious in this show. And like CM said, Twisted Metal on Peacock.
It's very good.
Twisted Metal's 10 episodes, 30 minutes a piece. They go by really quick.
Very quick.
They really don't spend time a whole lot on like arcs. It's kind of like he goes to one place and it's over in that episode.
And it's fun. It's so fun. Is. Like I was like, this show Andy is Mackie really so light and fun.
Kills it.
Great. Like this is like the best Anthony Mackie I've seen.
Yeah.
Right? I'm like, all right. Like,
yeah.
It really kind of blows, you know, the Falcon character out of the water. I was like, wow, I like you better like this than I do as Captain America.
Yeah. So any of you fans of Twisted Metal game, I would really suggest.
And wrestling fans, you get to see Samoa Joe's body. Right. Although I didn't realize he didn't do the voice.
No, it's Will Arnett.
Yeah, Will Arnett. Yeah. Who is great also. So, yeah, and I love that character, the Sweet Tooth character. Sweet Tooth. So, you've heard this old PlayStation 1 game, Twisted Metal. That's how old that is. So, I believe. PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2.
Yeah, I think so.
I think it was PlayStation 1.
Yeah, because when they show the game, it looks like that old fucking
PS1. Yeah. Very cool. Great suggestion. It's on Peacock, guys, from AA to watch that one. So, I've been enjoying it. But without further ado, guys, again, if you have any other news that you could think of or suggestions you want to talk about, by all means, feel free to bring it up during our conversation. But we're going to move right into our main topic because Well, we've been talking an hour about just news, so we might as well get right on into it, guys. We talked about earlier Echo has come out from Marvel. We talked about now that the Netflix shows are part of canon, which another exciting for that. If they do a season 3 of this show we're going to talk about today, maybe we can incorporate those characters, right? Double A, they're canon now, right? I mean, they're part of the universe, right? Mm-hmm. So you could include Daredevil, Luke Cage, Jessica Jones, Iron Fist.
That'd be so great.
How badass would that be? You know, what if the Defenders had fought alongside the Avengers? Ooh. You know what I mean?
Man.
But guys, one of the things, you know, Marvel's been catching shit, right? You know what I mean? It's like you have the failure of the Marvels, and then it's like, you know, but they go up and down, right? It's like they hit a win and they hit a loss, and they hit a win and they hit a loss. And I definitely got to say that, you know, the end of the year of 2023, Marvel gives us this Christmas gift, right, on December 22nd. And they're like, we're going to drop an episode every day up until New Year's Eve or the day before New Year's Eve, the 30th, you know, 9 episodes of What If. Season 2. If you were a fan of season 1, like we were, we covered it in 2 parts, 4 episodes and 4 episodes. I think we're going to do the whole season in 1 right now because I got a little picture for each one, so I'm pretty sure we are. I did not like this season as much as season 1 only, and I'll talk to you about it why. You know,
maybe I actually enjoy this one a lot more.
A lot more, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I want to hear your reasons why on that too. But love What If, have always loved those comics. Love the concept that Marvel's doing.
What a great idea that Marvel did at that time in the 70s. You know, most of them did turn out to be canon.
Yes, yeah.
Later on, as the writers, I guess, were fans of the What Ifs and were like, what if we really did make this?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And then
fun stories.
Marvel Studios, what a great idea to bring in this in and say, hey, let's do this with, you know, and again, they get a lot of the actors from the movies to do the voices.
I'm really surprised how they're able to do that. I wonder when they did that, because, man, they with the exception of Downey and Evans, they're able to get everyone.
And Scarlett
Johansson, they're able to get just about everyone else, but Lake Bell actually isn't bad.
Oh, no, she's great.
There's times when I forget that it's not Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah, Lake Bell is great as Black Widow.
Tone and kind of like rough voice that Scarlett Johansson has.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A huge part of it, you get Benedict Cumberbatch as Doctor Strange.
Too.
You know, Sebastian
Stan.
Soldier. The other big one I feel like that's always there is who does Captain Carter.
Oh, Haley Atwell.
Haley Atwell. I mean, she's, you know, a primary character. You know,
it's Chris Hemsworth, Benedict Cumberbatch, and they got Mark Ruffalo. They got Haley Atwell. Mm-hmm. They got Jeffrey Wright, who does Watcher.
Jeffrey Wright's great as the Watcher.
I mean, big star.
What's her name? Cate Blanchett. Voices Hela.
Yeah.
Hemsworth, obviously,
back as
Thor. Yeah, Jon Favreau. You know what I mean? So, I mean, that guy's super busy, right? But he's still going to be hey, I'm still going to be Happy Hogan. So, love that. Real quick, some comments as we get into it, though. Corey
goes, I blame Marvel's failure on Disney and their new age ideology.
Okay,
and it's kind of hoping Disney sells Marvel to Apple.
Okay, that's interesting. Joseph's Winter Soldier, what did I say? I probably said something else. Did I say Bucky? What did I say? I don't know what I said, but Sebastian Stan as Winter Soldier for sure. But let's get right into it. Double A is obviously the first episode we get, and who comes.
So right away, did you think it was going to connect again? Like before you saw anything, did you think it was going to connect? Because I was kind of having a feeling that it was.
To season one?
No, or just connect like a story again.
I can't even think if I did think they were. I think I was wondering in my mind, were they going to do that? Because
I kind of felt like I knew they were, but I was hoping they wouldn't.
Yeah.
I really would have liked a lot of these to just be kind of standalone.
Yeah.
You know?
So what
Double A's I hate when the Watcher gets involved.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. Which is not supposed to do. What Double A's referring to is like in season one, like the first 3 or 4 episodes are kind of standalones. And then they kind of like, you see them like kind of like by the end, they've all tied together. Mm-hmm. And I would say that this one kind of followed a similar formula because there was like 1, 2, or 3, maybe 4 episodes.
This one, standalone. This one seemed like a what if. I mean, a standalone. The second one felt like a standalone, and the third one felt like a standalone.
Well, let's talk about them, Double A. So this first one, what is this one called, Double A? What if
What if Nebula joined the Nova Corps?
What if Nebula joined the Nova Corps? Right, yeah. So the first thing you told me about this is that you were the one told me, you're like, you're gonna like it. You said away,
because I was like, it just had
Blade Runner vibes. And right away when I started watching it, I was like, oh yeah, Double A was totally right. It hits on all. If you love Blade Runner, you will love this episode.
So on this what if, Ronan does not deliver the stone, or I think he keeps the stone. Mm-hmm. He kills Thanos.
Mm-hmm.
and blows like Thanos the ship up, and so Nebula is just kind of like floating.
Yes.
And that's when what's her name? Glenn Close. Nova Prime.
Nova Prime, yes.
She picks up Nebula and makes her Nova Corps.
Nova Corps, yeah, right. So. Who are pretty much like the Green Lantern Corps.
You'd have to say yes for sure. Yeah. This is
they're Marvel's like the space police, the space cops.
This is Marvel's take on Green Lantern.
Yeah.
Nova Corps. But they're not nearly as strong or as revered like to comic book fans as the Green Lantern Corps. Mm-hmm. You know, like when you see the Green Lantern Corps come out in the comics, you're like, oh shit. Yeah. You brought in the cavalry.
No, totally.
You know, with the Nova Corps, you don't have that feeling whatsoever.
Absolutely.
And you know, we're just talking about, like, the names and, you know, Glenn Close. Like, how cool is that she did it again?
You know? So, I mean, again, I think Marvel has, they still have the reputation where if they call, you know, you're like, yeah, sure.
Okay, so check it out. So in this one, you know, Karen Gillan came back.
She's back as Nebula.
Jude Law, as Yon-Rogg.
Yes, the character from his character from Captain Marvel.
Yeah,
yes.
So Jude Law even came back. Michael Rooker came back. Seth Green came in as Howard the Duck.
Yeah, he did a great job.
Taika Waititi came back to do Korg.
Yeah, Taika's Korg.
And Glenn Close. So, I mean, that's
huge for an animated 30-minute episode series. You know what I mean? But again, I think Marvel still has the clout. They call, you answer, hey, you want to reprise your role as this character? You're like, yeah, it's Marvel. You know what I mean? Like, why wouldn't you do it? Real quick, Joe comments and says, I agree with AA on the standalones and not being canon. Yeah, absolutely. It's almost like they've developed a canon within the What If world.
Yeah.
And Jeremy's in the house says, What's up, Jeremy? Appreciate you being here, bud. Jeremy, did you watch What If? And if so, were you a fan of season one? Have you watched season two? Will you watch? And again, guys, spoilers are ahead.
I love the animation. I'm glad that it's not, you know, wonky, goofy looking.
Right. Like overly cartoony. Yes. You know what I mean? No, I 100% agree with you, AA. And this one is a lot of fun. A pretty much straightforward story of like a mystery.
It's a mystery. Yeah. A murder mystery.
Yeah. Yes. Nebula is essentially the Harrison Ford character in Blade Runner, and it looks gritty. You know, it's great. Korg is there, he's great. Groot. You know, it's just a fun kind of like a little mystery.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Howard has a one of his bigger roles.
Man, yeah.
Yeah. He's got a pretty big role. He's kind of running things in his little section of town.
But, you know, people have always said that those first Howard the Duck comics are really good.
Yeah.
That they're really well written and that he was a really popular character. It's the movie that kind of brings him down character stock down so,
and this definitely builds him back up. I think that's kind of like this smart too. You know, witty alien creature or whatever. Jeremy says loved it, especially the Marvel Zombies episode. Always liked that story.
That was a very popular one. Even my wife was really a big fan of that episode,
and I think people were hoping more zombies in this season and season two, which we do see one character come back. We'll talk about it when we get there. Yeah, great comment, Jeremy. You got to watch season two if you haven't already. So this was a fun episode. AA, pretty cut and dry. Like I said, if you love Blade Runner, you know what I mean? You know, again, spoilers ahead, guys.
Yeah, Ronan pretty much wants to, I think, destroy the planet.
Mm-hmm.
Nova Prime and Yon-Rogg are like, you know, they're opening this defense they put around the planet.
Mm-hmm.
They want to open it so Ronan can come in and destroy it or take over it.
Right.
Nebula does everything she can to avert that problem. You know,
yes. That gets thwarted, and then we, of course, find out
Nova Prime's a traitor.
Yeah. Which, what do you think about this, AA? When you see stuff like that in an episode like this, you know, we're talking about the multiverse, right? We're talking about the character. Does it mean, do you feel like that over the span of many multiverses that every character potentially, there's a bad version out there? Because even with Superman, right, we've got Injustice Superman now, who is like the bad Superman.
I think he almost had that. I think that's the Star Trek effect with the Mirror episode.
Okay.
Where they go and they're, you know, they go to a different parallel universe and they're terrible. It's not a United Federation. It's an empire.
Right.
You know,
right.
You got, you know, and they're all killing each other to be the next captain, you know. I would say
there's Star always Trek, that version of you that gives into your Star base. Trek
definitely had to be a big inspiration for a lot of these, where they're like, ooh,
yeah,
what if we make like instead of Justice League, we make it the Crime Syndicate,
right?
You know,
right?
You
right.
know, and how about that? Like, how about, and, you know, instead of Hulk, we make him the Maestro, and,
yeah,
you know, all that kind of shit, you know.
That
Age
baser
of Apocalypse is the one that really,
oh, yeah,
fucking twists flips everyone. Yeah,
that baser urge uh-huh. version of yourself exists out there somewhere, and is like, you know, because I was kind of like, damn, they make it seem like Nora Prime just like she would have. In that scenario, she's the bad guy. Yeah, you know what I mean? So, yeah. Very interesting.
But
it's
that's
fun.
What is always so fun about these what ifs, because we would see a different, like, one of the what if comics is like, what if Daredevil was with Kingpin? Was like one of his like right hand man. What if he was Kingpin's right hand man?
Right. Know? Or even in one of those episodes last season where we see that, you know, Thanos is part of like the Reaver or whatever. Like, oh, that's kind of like, not too
bad. Yeah, it's weird seeing him as a good
guy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that brings us to our next episode, kind of centers around Peter Quill.
And real quick, to go back to the first one, I don't think this one really connected to it. I don't think so.
I don't think they mentioned anything out of this one.
Yeah, so that was kind of cool that this one was just kind of
really
a standalone.
A standalone, for sure. Yeah.
I really enjoyed this one.
What if...
Episode two. If Peter Quill attacked Earth's mightiest heroes?
Yes, yes.
I really enjoyed this one because it was kind of cool to see what if Yondu
delivered Quill
to Ego.
Right, deliver him to Ego. Like,
and
he was
again,
supposed
to. This one we get Michael Douglas comes back, Haley Atwell,
yes,
Kurt Russell, mm-hmm. Chris Hemsworth, Lawrence Fishburne comes back, Sebastian Stan.
Yeah,
you know, and so we. We get quite a few.
We don't get Chris Pratt. He's the other one. He's the other, like,
yeah, he's the other one. But, I mean, I don't think his he would have...
No.
This would have been...
It was a kid anyway, yeah. Who did a great job. And mainly you got Kurt Russell there. You recognize Lawrence Fishburne
Michael
right away.
Douglas.
I forgot that Lawrence Fishburne was Goliath.
Yeah. Kurt Russell. Chris Hemsworth, like, fuck, you know?
Has Goliath been in other stuff?
No.
So this is, like...
Remember, this was another one, I think, of Hank Pym's... fucking identities.
Yeah.
You know, he had like Ant-Man, Spider-Man. I think Goliath was his other one.
Yeah.
And then Yellow Jacket, I think, was his other one too.
And Goliath in the comics, you know, the Civil War famously gets killed by, you know, the Ragnarok Thor, the robot. Is that Tony's robot Thor or whatever? Yeah. Who later on Thor pretty much gets in Tony's face about that. But so basically Yondu does deliver Quill to Ego. And then so again, you know, we talk about being a bad guy and a version of yourself, but, you know, in this one, since Quill is raised by him...
Yeah, this one takes place in 88. So, it's kind of like, okay, well, who the fuck would be Earth's Mightiest Heroes in 1988?
Right.
So, Peggy and Howard are still running S.H.I.E.L.D. at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And they recruit Bill Foster, Lawrence Fishburne's character. Mm-hmm. You know, so he's going to be Goliath. He's going to be your Giant Man.
Mm-hmm.
They get King T'Chaka, who's going to be, okay, your Black Panther.
Yes, that's really cool.
They're going to get... Bucky, Winter Soldier, so there's kind of like your super soldier. Dr. Wendy Lawson. Oh, that's Annette Bening from Captain Marvel, which is Captain Marvel.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
And so you got that one, and then you get Hank Pym coming back to play Ant-Man. So there's kind of like your Avenger team
of the 80s, which Joe says right here is good comedy. He says, I like that they did basically an 80s
Avengers
team.
That's kind of cool, because I was kind of like, cool. Oh, shit, yeah, okay, you did have an Avengers team, okay.
Yeah,
cool.
No doubt. I think the thing that we kind of see here, though, is that they're pretty outmatched.
Oh, yeah, you're talking about, so this is supposed to be like a fucking cosmic level being.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But it slowly shows that I guess he doesn't want to be.
Right.
Like Ego, right? Yeah. And so I think they're like, what if we get the kid to help us beat Ego?
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is where we have Wasp, you know, essentially Wasp, Hank's daughter, you know, she kind of forms a bond, you know, with Quill, and they talk about, you know, music, you know, things like that. Obviously, a big part of Quill's life from his mother was that. And then discovering, you know what I mean, ultimately that it was Ego that didn't really.
Oh, and then Thor comes in
for the mom.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, this is a pretty solid episode, too.
It was really good. It was really good. They meshed really well. I was like, man, this is pretty strong writing on this one.
Yeah, and it's always fun to just, like we said, hear the voices, right, too. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, damn, there he is again. Yeah.
Yeah, so they stop him, and then, like, they set off later. Thor's about to, you know, go. He's like, okay, I got to go. I got to go find Ego.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, well, we're a team now, you know. And so they all go together as the Avengers.
And Quill stays with them? Is that what happens? I don't remember.
No, I don't think he stays with them. Let me see. Oh, Pym takes him in.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, no, he tells him to stand against him with against his father. Okay. So I guess he goes with them. Yeah. I kind of forgot that part.
Yeah. Like some of the ends too were kind of like, I was like, I kind of like, what happened at the end? I don't remember the end.
But on this one, yeah, they do go after Ego at the end of that one. But that was actually a really damn good episode. I was really surprised. And these came out like a day. Like,
yeah,
each episode came out a day.
It premiered on the 22nd. So you got one the 22nd. Then you got one the 23rd.
And yeah, it ended the following Saturday.
And then this was a cool promo they had put out with the Watcher with the Christmas hat. I like
that poster a lot. That was really cool.
Because leading into the 24th, then we got the one which was...
I really didn't enjoy this one too much.
No, was it too diehard for you?
I don't know. It's just maybe the Happy Hogan character.
Like getting powers and all that.
Just being the central character.
So real quick, this one, guys. And again, John Favreau back at Happy Hogan. But what if Happy Hogan saved Christmas, right? Is that correct?
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I thought it was fun for the time. You know, it's Christmas Eve. You're going to watch an episode that night. And you know, but yeah. Kat Dennings comes back as
Kat Darcy. Dennings, Kobe Smulders comes back as Maria Hill, Sam Rockwell, Justin Hammer.
That was a neat comeback because I loved him. Yeah. You know, that was like the bright spot of that Iron Man. Was it two?
Yeah.
He's doing the dancing again, which I liked. You know what I mean?
Chris Hemsworth as Thor. Mark Ruffalo as Banner. Jeremy Renner comes back as Hawkeye.
Yes.
Lake Bell, again, substituting for Black Widow.
Mm-hmm.
And Ross Marquand as Werner. W.E.R.N. I guess he's a computer.
Is that the computer? Yeah. And Ross Marquand, a master of voice acting. Obviously, we know him as from The Walking Dead as Aaron. Is he Aaron? In The Walking Dead.
Yes.
Yeah, but he also was, you know, Hugo Weaving was only Red Skull in that first Captain America movie. Anytime you see the Red Skull after that, it's Ross Marquand in the makeup. It's a wonderful actor. Great job. Awesome that he's, like, still always doing stuff in Marvel. Why the hell wouldn't you? Joe says, quickly, he says, I took these shows to be very much in the same vein as some of the old animated series or even Super Friends episodes in the 80s and 90s. Oh, I think what Joe's meaning is that they're very, like, tongue-in-cheek. You know what I mean? They weren't meant to be take themselves too seriously.
No. It's just this one.
Yeah.
Like I said, I don't know. I'm just maybe it was like you said, it was him leading. I don't know. I really did enjoy the first two. I really, really loved those first two. This one, I was kind of like in and out, kind of like reading, kind of looking at the episode. Right. I was kind of like, okay, this one isn't really grabbing my attention.
Essentially, the plot on this one is that there's going to be a Christmas party, right?
He's supposed to be security
at the Avengers Tower. Yeah. Happy's supposed to be security, and then they find out that there's Justin Hammer is there, and he's trying to
stake Tony's tag and a sample of Bruce's blood.
Bruce's blood, right, to get power or whatever. And then ultimately, Happy gets injected with the blood, and we get kind of like this, like, Smart Hulk happy. That's also, and he essentially does, well, you know, save Christmas and save the Christmas party. So it's fun. There's a lot of, like, Christmas movie references. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we see him right here. in the Die Hard type tunnel or whatever. And they make a couple of other references to Die Hard in that as well. Mm-hmm. Even like the kind of the far off shot of the building and things going on. I think even Darcy says, "You want me to be your Reginald Bell Johnson?" He's like, "That's what you remember of the movie." You know? So I thought it was fun. You know, again, if you're watching it on Christmas Eve, it's a good watch probably every Christmas.
Yeah, which it was. You know. Yeah, Christmas Eve.
So, but yeah, straightforward episode. I don't know that this one, well, the Happy character becoming the Hulk thing does tie back in later.
That one starts connecting.
Right. So that takes us right to the Christmas Day episode.
What if Iron Man crashed into the Grandmaster?
How'd you feel about this one?
It was fine. It was all right. Jeff Goldblum comes back. Tessa Thompson comes back. Josh Brolin comes back. So it's, you know, pretty cool.
Now, AA, is this the one that we were supposed to have gotten last season where it had the Gamora thing? Was it the whole Gamora thing? Or is that a different episode I'm thinking of?
I don't know.
Because the thing was that last season, I think, or in season one, they had said that there was a Gamora episode with the Hulkbuster. And it showed the Hulkbuster with, like, this, like, kind of like this like war paint on him, and they had even released a Lego set of it. I think I talked about it in our season one episode, but for whatever reason it got cut and they didn't get to release it, so they had to, they were going to release it with season two. So
All right. I
was trying to remember if they showed that in this. They do show the whole cluster, don't they? I thought they did in this one. Maybe I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, somebody let me know. Joe says, read a Justin Hammer rumor about Armor Wars. That'd be interesting. Shit. I like how you spelled it there, Joe. Armor, like the little Vienna sausages. This is a fine episode. I don't know who the guy that does Tony Stark is. He's not too bad, though. It sounds kind of Tony-ish at times.
Mick Winger.
Okay.
Yeah, pretty much it's a car on the planet, and you
it's
know,
like a big...
Obviously, Grandmaster cheats a lot. Yeah. You know, he's...
It's like a race. The episode's like a big race.
It felt like kind of like Phantom Menace.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. I was like, oh, this is very like, you know, pod racer.
Pod race. Which,
which may have been like, would people refer to, I don't know. I never seen Cannonball Run, but is that what's going on in Cannonball Run? Or Logan's Run?
Oh, you know, no, not Logan's Run. You're right. Cannonball Run. Yeah, okay. Logan's Run, the science fiction one where.
Okay.
Once you turn 27, I think you get killed or some shit like that. Or 20. It's 20 something.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, that's what kind of was the central theme of this one, was that it was like a big race or whatever, and ultimately they had to thwart the Grandmaster, who Jeff Goldblum is great as the Grandmaster anytime he comes out. So sometimes you feel a little bit too, you're like, oh, this was kind of like, you know, you get him again, but you're going to waste him on this. You know what I mean? Like, but and it was fine. Solid ep. I mean, nothing to, you know, whatever. But yeah.
Episode 5 is... What if Captain Carter fought the Hydra Stomper?
Yeah, so now we're back.
I think this is the kind of the beginning
of them tying together.
Yeah.
So we bring back Haley Atwell as Captain Carter.
Samuel Jackson as Nick Fury. Mm-hmm. Frank Grillo comes back as Rumlo.
Yes.
Sebastian Stan. Rachel Weisz comes back. Elizabeth Olsen comes back.
Who was Rachel Weisz?
The one that taught Black Widow. Remember in the movie?
Oh, right. That's right.
Black Widow movie.
Right. Yes. Yeah. And in this one, too, Lake Bell and Haley Atwell are like kind of friends. I mean, it's Black Widow and them teaming up.
It's Captain Carter. Captain America's story from, you know, Winter Soldier. But yes. It's them two now.
Yeah. So it's cool that they're buddied up. They find out that the Hydra Stomper has been found.
Yes. And it was in this, you know, in the Soviet Union.
Yes.
And he's been brainwashed. It's kind of like the Bucky story.
Right.
With him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in fact, in this one, Bucky's older. He's old. And yes. He's like the president or senator or something. He's a
yes.
Senator.
Yes. He's got the role, I think, that Robert Redford had.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, without the Hydra shit.
So I thought this one was fun. It was pretty cool.
It was fun.
Like,
yeah.
You know, I like Haley Atwell as Captain Carter. I like the Captain Carter character. I didn't like what happened to her in Multiverse of Madness. You know, seeing her live action.
I know, that's kind of weird, right? That you keep going back to her after that shit. Yeah.
I think I made my dad a fan because my dad was like starting to look for her Funko Pop. And then,
I went to GameStop tonight, I saw her shield.
Oh, really?
They have the shield of her. Yeah, so I was like, oh, wow. Yeah. I didn't see how much. I was afraid to look.
But... Yeah. Yeah. So I ended up giving my dad my Funko Pop of her. Of her. Okay. I had her because I just like the character, the way she looks and stuff like that. And Haley Atwell was a babe. So,
Yeah.
What'd you think about this episode, Double A?
It was fun, like you said, it was fun. It's kind of like Winter Soldier, but, you know, all fucking different roles.
Yeah, different roles. Yeah, yeah, twisted around.
At the end of this one, she gets transported, a portal.
Yes.
To a Renaissance theme universe.
Yes.
It says where she encounters variants of Fury and Wanda.
Yes. And so we see that kind of like at the end, and then that's going to lead us into an episode later. But this was the...
Well, yeah, so in this one, I think Steve dies still. I think he sacrificed himself.
Right.
Blows up the Red Room's main operations. Yeah. Some shit like that. So she loses Steve again.
Again. And she's poor, you know, Captain Carter. She's having to deal with that. So this one is like on the 26th. So we're going into December 27th. And this is probably the most talked about episode. Yeah. The one that everyone loved.
I was like, do I know this character? I was like actually rattling my brain. I was like, I don't remember... A fucking super-powered Indian.
I don't either.
So this one is episode 6, like CM said. What if Kahori reshaped the world?
So brand new character. Native American character. What tribe, Double A, they say? Mohawk Indian, I believe. They say the Mohawk Indian.
Oh, yeah, Mohawk. Yes.
Yeah, voiced by DeVery Jacobs. DeVery Jacobs. Alora Dannon from Rez Dogs. Yes, Hernet. She's named after the character from Willow in the show. She's wonderful, super tough, super badass in Rez Dogs. And then an equally, I would say, tough and badass character here in the Marvel U. This episode is all in the native language, languages. So Spaniards show up. They speak Spanish. And the Mohawk Indians speak their native language in this episode as well. But I don't know if you know this, Double A. If you go to the extras, do you ever go to extras when you're on Disney? I went to that on this one, and they have the episode all in English, so you can hear it. You can hear it all in English if you want. Sometimes when I want to hear it in the background, like if I'm like doing stuff like ironing or whatever, it's good so that way I don't have to read the words. So I thought that was cool that they offered that option. This was by far my favorite episode. I don't know how
it
you
was
felt.
The most talked about. I liked it right away. It was the most talked about. So this one sort of destroys Asgard during Ragnarok, and the Tesseract lands in the lake where they're at,
mm-hmm.
and it gives them like magical properties. That's how she becomes like super powered up.
Yes, yeah. And Joe has a great question here. He says, so she is a brand new character, brand new no comics. Brand That's new. Correct, Joe. Yeah, first appearance here in the What If show season 2. So very, very cool. And to kind of go back to Echo real quick, I didn't know, you know, because again, her name is Maya Lopez in the Echo show. The primary character, Alana Cox, or Alquana Cox. But she's also a Native American. And I didn't know that the character in the show was Native American in Echo. They're supposed to be Choctaw Indians in that show. So I thought I just want to say it's really cool. I thought it's really cool, you know, after us covering Res Dogs, but that they're giving, you know, credit and screen time and FaceTime to Native American, you know, creating Native American characters and showcasing Native American
Honestly,
characters.
I think this is the only kind of like race that Marvel really hadn't done anything on.
Yeah.
Because Marvel pretty much covered all bases.
I mean, I guess we had like in the like X-Men the days, 60s, like Thunderbird 70s, and 80s. Warpath.
Yeah, that's right.
We had them. You know what I mean?
Stupid. Yeah, of course.
But I mean, you know, but again, kind of like side X-Men characters. Like, you know, this is like they're kind of bringing it to the forefront, you know?
Yeah.
So that was pretty cool. Mojo Potato says, the voice actress also plays... Yeah. Maya's cousin in Echo. Yes, correct. Yeah, she also comes out in that too.
If you've seen Reservation Dogs, she's great in Reservation Dogs.
It's Reservation Dogs. Yeah, FX and Hulu. We did an episode on that as well, Mojo Potato, if you want.
Yeah,
if you
haven't checked it
out. Our episode does have spoilers, but if you get a chance to check out that show, Reservation Dogs is a fantastic show, and a lot of the cast you see in Echo are in that show as well. But yeah, so basically this is the story of how she gets to her powers, mm-hmm. and then when and they say reshape the world, she pretty much drives off the Spaniards, and so this is like the story of like American history in a sense.
It really is, and I told my wife, it's kind of funny because like if you ever see a movie that takes place in the 40s, obviously you see Nazis and mm-hmm. that's the enemies. Well, if you ever see, you know, America when the Indians were here and you see a conquistador, that's kind of like, you know,
right.
You're like, oh shit.
Right.
You know, that's not going to be good at all. And kind of it plays up to that here again, the conquistadors come and right away want to enslave and kill and all that shit. So,
and I loved it because it's almost like, wow, how is the world different? Would the world be different in that way? And it got me thinking about a question that I asked you. Is that too controversial to talk about? No. I mean, it got me just thinking about things like, you know, that.
I told him I think it is. You know, it's just that we don't talk about it because we're still here.
And I know AA is a big history buff, and it just got me thinking about it again, too, because, I mean, you know, we're products of the American education system. I mean,
not going to talk about this.
Right. And I told AA, I said, do you think that, you know, what happened to the Native Americans, you know, here in the United States is equivalent to the Holocaust? And he answered me pretty quick. He said, yes,
because there's even, you know, President Andrew Jackson, who did not like Indians whatsoever, wanted to get rid of all of them, wanted to kill all of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's still certain Indians that will not accept a $20 bill because they see Andrew Jackson on there. You know, so it's, I mean, to us, he's American president. To them, he's a fucking murderer.
Yeah.
You know, a killer. I mean, they came in and that's all they wanted to do. They came in and Cortez came and killed the Aztecs, killed off the Aztecs. These guys wanted to kill off the Indians for some reason.
Yeah.
You know, it's like not even live with them, not even learn
right
how to do it. I mean, it was just total wipeout, total annihilation.
Yeah.
You know, it's just... It was like, fuck, there's people that want to wipe out an entire race of humans.
Yeah.
You know?
Genocide. You know what I mean? And so in that respect, in my mind, I thought it is equivalent. You know what I mean? I think it is the same thing. It's just like double.
Like I said, when there's Indians that won't take a fucking 20.
Right.
You know, because it's like, you know who this fucker is?
Yeah,
he's absolutely killing my people.
I mean, we just did the whole thing. You know, we just went through the thing kind of as a country with the statues being removed of the... you know, the Confederate, you know, generals and things like that, Confederate heroes. It's like, why are we kind of, weren't these the bad guys? You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
they were traitors.
You know, they were, yeah, said that. They were traitors. They
turned
their
back on their oath.
You know, and again, I mean, history's waters are muddied, but again, I asked my girlfriend the same question. I only asked her and you.
Look, it's pretty much this. Look, Rome, if Rome hadn't fallen, what kind of history would they have done on themselves? Unfortunately, Rome did fall, and there's lots of shit that you can gather where pretty much everybody writes about the whole existence, good and bad, mm-hmm. of it, right? Mm-hmm. I mean,
mm-hmm. yeah.
You know, what if we fall in like 100 years, they write the history of America. It's all right. going to be there. It's all going to be right. laid out. Everything.
You know, and again, too, Double, like when we were talking about it in our Reservation Dogs episode, you know, I mean, it's like, you know, it's such a, I think, a beautiful, rich culture, a culture that, A, cared very much about the planet and the
they
earth.
They taught them how to survive here.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in their thank you is, okay, thanks. Now we're going to kill you and we're going to, you know, kidnap your women and your children, shave their head and make them speak English and make them worship this one God.
Right.
You know, I mean, to them, there wasn't no one God. It was, they prayed to people. They prayed to whatever their deities were.
Yeah.
And now this race comes in and tells them, what you're doing is wrong. You look like a fucking savage. And you're going to pray to this one God and you're going to speak our language. It's kind of like, fuck, like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
You know, like, man, that's brutal. Like, you know, and that's, again, they taught them how to survive in the winter when they were dying off. They were dying. Bad. Yeah. They couldn't grow food and they showed them how to do it. They showed them how to survive. You know, they just, you know, it's kind of after that, it was like, okay, we don't need you, you know?
Yeah.
But I sure do like your wife.
Oh, no, yeah. It's fucking horrible. It is horrible. And again, I mean, I think it's something that should be talked about and should be recognized as the fact that,
I mean, how would we feel? Some, all of a sudden, some fucking, you know, foreign, you know, counterpart came and, you know, defeated us and then told us, okay, you can't speak English anymore. You have to speak this language.
Yeah.
You know, like,
I think when it happens to us, it'll be aliens, probably.
You know, it'll be like, oh, shit.
Yeah. It'll probably be the aliens that come kick our ass, though.
But you know what I mean? It's kind of like, man, these people are coming in and saying everything that you've been doing is wrong, and our way is the right way.
Right, and it's like, who are you to say?
Exactly, who are you?
I really love this story here with Kahori because it's pretty much like, well, she has power.
This is kind of like a Tarantino, kind of like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, where it's
rewriting
kind of like,
history.
Instead of Manson and his followers killing Sharon Tate, they run into, you know, Leo and Brad Pitt. And they kill.
Yeah.
You know, they run into Rick Dalton. And a stunt double, and they kill the Manson followers, and everything is, you know, sunny and beautiful, or Inglourious Basterds, where
Hitler gets a gun out of the theater.
They kill everyone at the theater, and the war is over, just like that. You know, unfortunately. Unfortunately, this is still, it's called What If. And, this.
But it makes me want to see more of, like, Kahori's world. Like, so what happens after
that? Which I think, because I saw nothing but positive after this episode. Yeah. I was a little worried. I was like, great, they're going to, people are going to say, oh, you know, they're pushing this agenda, pushing that agenda. But everyone seemed real pleased with the episode. Mm-hmm. Everyone seemed to enjoy this episode. And I always do think, see him again, I think it's better when you just create characters instead of trying to put this on some other character,
right.
What I mean, I think that's what people get pissed off is when you try doing this to another character,
although they do have Thunderbird and
Warcraft. No, but you know, not like saying you put this like this whole story on somebody else,
what I mean, sure,
like
sure,
you
sure.
twist, like you make Spider-Man Indian all of a sudden, okay, well, that's, you know, people are obviously going to get pissed off. It was like,
oh yeah,
you know.
Yeah, bad. Absolutely.
But, you know, I think it being original, it being an original character, and the powers being received by the Tesseract, you know, all that. So it's kind of like, oh, shit, okay.
I thought it was very cool. I thought it was very very well done.
Yeah.
You know, again, I hope I'm saying her name right. Devery. Jacobs is great as Kahori. And it made me excited to see what her world that she shaped is like. Like, what is that? What is that section of the multiverse like? Because she wasn't the only one with power. A lot of people had been absorbing the power, but she seemed to take to it faster than anybody else and could
manipulate like
the
power. Like it stayed with her.
Because it's hard to say, what would you say her powers were? It was like,
well,
she had, like,
see,
energy
so Tesseract is kind of, I guess, it's a gem, ain't it?
Yeah.
In the MCU movies. So she has kind of like an unlimited source.
An Infinity Stone worth of power, right?
Yeah, reality warping power, maybe.
Okay.
Maybe. Yeah. I mean, she can get to place to place.
She seemed like she was kind of moving and manipulating things like in like a Green Lantern-ish type way where it's like, I think it and I can kind of create it. So, yeah. I mean, that could be like the reality stone. I mean, so I always get the colors confused because it's different from the comics. They're not the same colors.
And then even in the comics, it's Cosmic Cube.
Right.
Cosmic Cube. So, obviously she got cosmic powers.
Right. So, again, great episode. I loved it. I love the idea of it. You know what I mean? And again, too, I think anything that gives positive attention and positive light, you know, to the Native American, you know, culture and people is badass. You know what I mean? Like, why not build up, you know, this other avenue?
Which, again, this is going to connect too, because at the end, you know, she goes to see that Queen Isabella, you know, kind of tells her stand down.
Yes.
But then Dr. Strange Supreme comes and, you know, he's still like kind of like dark Dr. Strange.
Yeah.
You know, and he's kind of like, I need you or some shit like that. And that's the way that episode ends.
Right.
So the next one's episode 7, which CM had just put, what if Hela found the 10 rings, which I was really interested in. So I was kind of like, okay, cool.
So now we're kind of tying in a little bit of like Thor Ragnarok. Thor Ragnarok and Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings. No Shang-Chi in this episode, but we do get Cate Blanchett back.
And the father, right? That's Shang-Chi's father, Mandarin or whatever.
Right. He was like the primary villain in that movie.
I think he is supposed to be Mandarin, though.
Is he Shang-Chi's father, though? I'm not sure.
Yes, he's Shang-Chi's father.
Okay.
But I think he goes by the name Mandarin.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, they still kind of even fucked that one.
I couldn't remember.
They still kind of fucked that one up.
Yeah, that was like a little bit like, what? What's going on here?
Yeah.
But what's neat is that, like,
I'm not going to lie, though. I kind of like the 10 rings idea instead of being on the hands.
On, like, actual rings. Yeah. They're like big rings.
Yeah, because, like, what happens in the comics to the Mandarin is kind of like what happens to Sauron. He has the rings on his hands. Well,
excuse me.
Somehow somebody cuts his hands off. So I was kind of, okay, well, shit, all right, he doesn't have power anymore because the fucking rings are in his hands. So I was like, shit, that's brutal.
You know? Yeah, like Sweet Tooth? Yeah. Need a hand? Yeah, you got to get one of your own. This one's mine. but it's really cool that Cate Blanchett is back as Hela. The episode starts kind of similar to what we see with her and Thor meeting up, but only it's her and Odin. You know, even going as far as to when Thor throws, you know, Mjolnir at her and she grabs it and bursts it. Her helmet is what he grabs and bursts. Mm-hmm. Odin grabs her helmet and bursts it.
Yes.
And Odin's not Anthony Hopkins in this one, right?
No. Unfortunately not.
No, but cool. But still, yeah, so she pretty much is the one who gets cast down to Earth without power.
Yeah, so she's Thor, like CM saying. But yeah, she gets cast down.
Yeah.
And she has to, I guess, learn humility.
Yeah, and she's very funny in this, too, where she talks about, like, wanting, like, flame daggers. Yes. And I was like, okay, Cate Blanchett's kind of playing it up, like, hamming it up a little bit. But, or, you know, that's how it was written. But I thought that was a good move for her character because you're kind of like, it made Hela kind of likable. And this one, and obviously the Mandarin character takes a shine to her because she's, you know, all about that. He's intrigued by her, right? Yeah. And so she does kind of, I guess, would you say, does learn kind of humility?
Yeah, she does, big time. Odin comes, finds her, you know, he's amazed at what she's learned. She's not as arrogant anymore, as bloodthirsty. He gives the throne to her.
Yeah.
So Hela becomes, you know, she unites the Asgard armies with his 10 rings army.
Yeah. And she becomes...
And they go from realm to realm to free people or... You know,
and there's that great shot of her, like, kind of like all in white with her helmet. I always thought her helmet looked cool into the Hela character.
And then I forgot, too, I'm reading this. It says, like, they show them to coming to the rescue of Gamora's people as Thanos is about to attack them.
That's right. Yeah.
It's kind of like, so it's kind of being implied they're going to stop Thanos
as well
and his army. Yeah.
I dig that, too. This was a cool one, I thought. So
it was really cool. Yeah. It was really cool. Now, this one is probably the one that was the most anticipated.
Yes, and I couldn't find a good picture of this one. That's fine. Yeah, this is kind of like them in the court. What if the
Avengers assembled in 1602? Now, Neil Gaiman had wrote 1602 like a 5-parter, I think, or a 6-parter, and so people loved it. People loved that 1602. They loved what he did, taking some of the characters back, like into the 1600s.
Right.
So people were very excited about that. He did get a special thanks.
Okay, cool.
Section. So that was cool. What do you think of this episode,
though? So I don't really remember what the 1602 story was about, but this feel like it didn't really follow that by any means, other than it took place in 1602, but it seemed like they kind of had tech and things like that.
So
like,
check this one out. So Haley Atwell's back.
Mm-hmm.
Samuel Jackson's back. Elizabeth Olsen's back. Chris Hemsworth is back. Tom Hiddleston is back.
Nice.
Mark Ruffalo is back. Jon Favreau is back. Paul Rudd comes out. Sebastian Stan. Benedict Cumberbatch. Blake Bell comes back. So it was like, man, this was pretty heavy loaded.
They got everybody in this.
Pretty much.
And you have the Steve Rogers Captain America character is kind of like the Robin Hood.
Uh-huh.
Who's in charge? Thor is like the king, right?
Yes.
And so, yeah. Joe says 1602 he enjoyed a lot. You mean the comic, Joe, or do you mean this episode? I don't know how far you got. He says Bruce in the Iron Mask. Yes, yeah, yeah. You get Bruce Banner in the
Right, some people thought it was Doom, like a Doom looking mask. I didn't really see it that much, but...
No,
but I think people were like, oh, that might be an Easter egg that,
right.
that he's coming.
I don't think so, yeah. But that the Man in the Iron Mask always did kind of look like a Doom-ish type mask. In fact, they may have gotten Doom based off of that. I don't know if there were early images of that, but even when you see the Leonardo DiCaprio movie, like that mask looks kind of like... I mean, you know, Dr. Doom's mask is gray, you know what I mean? And then with like the eye holes and then the way the mouth is, so it kind of like... Any mask that's like that's going to kind of look like that. You could even say like the early, the first Iron Man mask, you know, kind of bears a resemblance.
Yeah, no sure.
But yeah, so this one is cool. what's essentially the story here, Double A, is that they're trying to get Tony's building something for him.
He's fucking up, like he's causing the portals or some shit like that.
I think so. I don't remember the exact plot of this one. But Captain Carter's there, obviously displaced from the couple episodes back when we saw her. She runs into, again, the Robin Hood type character who ends up being Steve. She's like, you know, again, all like, man, I'm, you know, you're the guy. He talks about having fought Thanos at one point and hitting a stone with the shield.
Yeah.
The time stone.
Yes.
And then he got shot out of time. Yeah.
Yes, from Infinity War. That's right. That's that Captain America.
Yeah. So it's like that.
It's Super Soldier Cap. Split. Should be.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he's like buff and stuff. Yeah. He's not like a regular one.
No, he's not all scrawny.
Yeah. And he even has this shield that's kind of shaped like the one that he got like from Wakanda. So, I'm trying to think
what the primary Steve.
Heavy is that.
Steve is the one who's causing kind of like all the shit.
Right.
And Thor is thinking it's Carter. It's Captain Carter.
Right, right.
Yeah. That's right. And so Tony, I guess, is trying to get Steve back.
Yes.
To his, so he can stop all the...
The stuff that's happening.
All the stuff that's happening.
Right.
That's right, that's right.
Yeah, and Happy becomes the Hulk-type character again,
too. Yeah, because he's, like, with Thor.
Yeah, throughout, he's kind of almost like your Sheriff of Nottingham-type guy, or whatever. So, again, it had, like, Robin Hood-ish vibes to it.
Well, yeah, that's what it is. They ask Captain Carter to help with the anomaly, but then Thor, he starts thinking it's Carter's. He's not thinking it's Steve.
Right.
It is Steve. He's the one that's kind of fucking everything up. And then they fix it to where he can go back.
Yeah. Joe says, Carter doesn't save Hela and Thor turns on her. That's right. Yes. Yeah. But again, they're building kind of like, now they're intertwining the stories a little bit. So.
And she's kind of still the main part, the main part of it all.
Yeah, and she sacrifices and ends up thinking she's stuck in 1602.
So now she's lost Steve again.
Yeah, and she's stuck in 1602.
But then Strange appears.
Right.
And tells he's her, like, yeah, I can send you home, but can you help me first?
Right, right. Which takes us to the last episode, right?
Episode 9. This is what if Strange Supreme intervened?
Yes, 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 yes.
And it says here he takes... Captain Carter to his sanctum where he reveals that he's been capturing universe killers to atone for his sins and asks her to help him fighting Kahori.
Kahori, right? Yes. Yeah.
Which, you know, she not knowing that he's taking everyone's power so he can feed his fucking weird monster and bring back his world so he can have Christine back again.
Exactly. So we realize here that he's still nuts.
Dark.
Yeah. We see like the return of Killmonger. You know, he's got, you know, and I like that this one early on, AA, it like Carter finds Kahori and they kind of get on the same page quickly. It wasn't like a classic, like they keep fighting, you know, senselessly or whatever. Because at first, Carter's happy to see him. And again, you know, although we saw Strange go dark in season one, he kind of redeems himself a little bit, you know what I mean, to become this guy that's like, you know, mastering these, keeping these things, you know, from getting out, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Only to find out that, you know, he's already driven himself to nuts. And again, his goal is to...
This is the last episode. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's all right.
I'm sorry.
I forget what she calls it. What does she call it?
The what?
The big thing he's trying to feed.
Oh, the forge.
The forge, yeah.
He's still trying to bring his plan back. It's almost like the Green Lantern storyline, almost, when he loses Cold City.
Yes.
And he does everything he can. He absorbs every Green Lantern power he can to where he hopes he can resurrect Cold City.
Yeah.
It's almost that storyline, almost.
Right, right.
Except they're doing Strange. Strange is kidnapping every kind of fucking powerful being he could come across in each multiverse to feed it to this monster so it'll have enough power to bring back his world, which is dead. It's a dead fucking planet.
Right. So that he can have Christine back again.
And he needs Carter because he's like, she's kind of the only one he thinks he can still would help him that doesn't know him. You know, but like CM says, Gohori convinces Carter what's really going on. But this dude is like psycho. Yeah.
And it's great. Like Benedict Cumberbatch is really great in this kind
of role. He really is. Yeah.
Because he even tells her a couple times, he's like, come on, you wouldn't do the same thing for Steve?
And I know a lot of people don't like the Doctor Strange Multiverse of Madness, but when he does that role in the Multiverse of Madness, it's pretty fucking chilling.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially when the eye opens up.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then, too, he kind of becomes like this, you know, the demon version of Strange. Yeah, it's ugly. And Kahori flexes her power, too. We really see how strong she is. And then there's this great scene at the end, right? Double A, you know, spoilers. But where, you know, Hela's like, you know, give him hell or whatever. She throws Captain Carter her helm. You know, we see Thor throw the hammer. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And by this point, she's already gotten the armor off of Killmonger.
Yeah,
you know, Kahori handles up him pretty quick. Yeah,
so Carter, that's right. Carter has the fucking Infinity Stones while Kahori is super powered herself. So,
Right.
So it's like these two powerful beings, and it kind of makes you wonder, like, fuck, how strong is this Strange?
This Strange,
Like he's able to still kind of fight off Kahori, Tesseract powered Kahori, and, you know, Infinity Stones Captain Carter. You're like, whoa, what the fuck?
And I kind of got to chalk it up a little bit, too, to, like, it seemed like Carter didn't really know how to use that power.
And I wouldn't think he would.
No.
You know, especially no one's told you about him, or really kind of told you.
And even then, it's easy, like, to say, like, oh, well, if I had power like that, I would do all these things. And it's like, yeah, but not if you're, like, just kind of thinking about it. Because I think at one point, she's, like, re-manifesting shields and throwing them at him. And I'm like, come on, Carter, you got to do something else. But what are you going to think of? You know what I mean? Like, just because power is at your, you know, you'd have to tell the Mind Stone, like, you know, tell me what will defeat him, and then use the Reality Stone, and then use the Power Stone. So, meanwhile, Strange is the, you know, Sorcerer Supreme, so he's, you know, wielding magic like nothing, you know what I mean? Hell, there's even a part where he's like, you know, you can't stop all of us. He creates a bunch of himself. And she's like, oh, great idea.
Great idea. Do the
same thing. Really, she didn't have any ideas. Someone like her is, like, used to fighting hand-to-hand, you know what I mean? They're not going to be thinking of, like, all this shit or whatever. Yeah. Hell, even Kahori, pretty new to her powers, isn't going to be able to necessarily take on someone like Strange.
Who's already had years of experience with it.
Yeah. So, what happens here, Double A? I mean, obviously, Kahori and Captain Carter are able to stop.
Yeah, he sacrifices himself because I guess he's separated enough of that demon shit.
Yeah.
That he takes into the forge.
He calls it his grief. He's like, my grief is too strong now. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So he sacrifices himself. Everything kind of... He does resurrect the planet.
Yeah.
Because he's not there in anymore. He's not in it anymore. Watcher takes Kahori back home. And he... You know, she's... Captain Carter's kind of like, well, can you finally take me home now? And she's like, yeah. And he takes her through a stroll through the multiverse. But then he shows her... Like the ending of Loki with the tree. I can't say that fucking tree thing.
I don't remember what it's called either.
Drixil, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But I was like, holy shit, are they connecting that with the Loki scene too?
Because he
was
like,
you're going to see like a power like like you haven't seen before. And it's the fucking tree because that's what they show in Loki where he's holding all the fucking multiverses together.
Yeah, because she says basically like before we go home, can we take a little detour or whatever? And he's like, oh, you have no idea. So it's neat. Basically, I guess kind of like opening the door for like other seasons. And I guess
Captain Carter. I mean, that's what I got. Is that what you got, right?
Oh, like, yeah, for
like
sure.
Like Loki.
Yeah, that that's when I saw the Asgard tree. The second time, the tree again. Yeah, the Asgard tree for sure. which is very cool because anytime that these tie into the things like, and again, they touch on things that we've seen already, but you know what I mean? Like, that's like fairly new. And I mean, like, obviously, we know that Loki is kind of the loom now. I mean, they call it they're calling it the loom, right? Like, holding all the threads of the multiverses. So, and you know, hearing that Captain Carter is going to be kind of like maybe traveling those, I guess she'll be kind of like our, you know, the real world, you know, real world, quote unquote, guide walking through. You know, obviously we've got the Watcher, but you know, he can't intervene, but she's there and she can, I guess, can intervene, you know. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's why she wants to see like what she can do, whatever. And you know, she even tells Steve at one point, she's like, I think she tells the 1602 Steve, she's like, we never get our happy ending. And he says to her, he's like, I'm sure out there in one of those universes we do. So it'd be neat to maybe she gets to eventually see that. Now, AA, you said that you did not like, you liked this one better than the one season one. Let's talk a little bit about why, and I'll tell you a little bit why I didn't maybe like it as much.
I mean, I thought the stories were a little bit stronger.
Okay.
I really enjoyed where it went. I'm kind of like, it was cool seeing the 80s Avengers. It was cool seeing them pull that group. It was cool kind of seeing Peter, what he could really be capable of.
Right.
The Blade Runner episode was good.
Yeah. No doubt.
This one was really fun. I thought this was a great ending.
Yeah, no, I thought it was cool too.
Like, it really felt intense.
Yeah.
You know, them two going against, you know, a fucking really strong Doctor Strange. I thought that was really good.
No, no doubt.
The Grandmaster one made me laugh. I know you really didn't enjoy that one.
Yeah, it was not too...
It made me laugh. I think the only one, like you said, I didn't really care for was the Happy Hogan
one. The Happy Hogan one. Yeah, I thought that one was...
Don't get me wrong. The season one is great. Ultron, it really showed what a badass Ultron really is. Like, he is in the comics. You know how he's like... going from multiverse to multiverse, destroying it.
Yeah.
The zombie episode obviously was a highlight too.
Yes.
I don't know. It's just this one, it didn't seem like they tried tying everything in. You know what I mean?
Right.
The only thing is, I don't know why they keep focusing on the Captain Carter being like the central figure of these what ifs. So
I don't know
especially
either.
Especially after, like you said, especially after Multiverse of Madness, where
they kill her. Yeah. And that's like,
which he's such like a central figure in these two seasons of what if.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
So I guess I'd say the only thing that maybe I didn't, and again, I really did enjoy it. And again, both seasons have like some weak episodes. I know we both didn't like that Party Thor episode in season one. Yeah. You know what I mean? But like, you know, again, it's meant to be like kind of like Joe said earlier, you know, tongue in cheek and like remind us of like the 80s, 90s cartoons and be kind of fun. But what for me I didn't like is I felt like the zombie episode and the episode 4 on season one, the Doctor Strange episode, which is... what if Doctor Strange lost his heart instead of his hands? Ooh. The one I famously watched like 4 times, and we were like, why did you do that to yourself?
That was dark.
There really wasn't an episode like this to me in this season. There was no downer. You know what I mean? Like, I kind of like, well, the thing about What If, right, AA, that I like in the comic books is that sometimes the story went bad. You know what I mean? Like, even like when Surfer gets the gauntlet, like he kind of turns evil. You know, in that comic book episode, then he kind of has to, like, think, what does he do? He gives it up or something
He gives it up,
Because he gives
himself and Shalabah their little own personal heaven.
Yeah.
And he's like, here you go. He gives it to, like, Warlock.
Yeah, he was, like, corrupted by the power. So I like when they mix in the stories of, like, good things happen and bad things happen. You know what I mean? So this one seemed like, you know, I don't know. I would like them to peel a little bit away of maybe some of the humor. You know what I mean? Like, humor is fine or whatever, but, like, in... I don't need an episode of What If to be like a funny episode. It's fine if there's humor within the episode. Like, I mean, I thought that, who did we talk about that I said was funny? Oh, like when Hela's making jokes in that episode, she's making jokes, but they're within her character, like as she's meant to be. Like, she's kind of like, you know, into like death and destruction or whatever, you know what I mean? So she's making jokes about that. The humor's fine that way, but I don't need like an entirely like funny episode of it. You know what I mean? Like maybe what AA is saying, kind of like with the Christmas episode or in the first one, that Party Thor episode, I'm like, I don't really care, like, what if that happened? Like, I'd rather know, like, what if, like, these other things happened? And I did see, like, a lot of people that really were loving this season were saying how much they were like, man, we wish Marvel would do, like, or, you know, Disney would do, like, what if in the Star Wars universe, which you wouldn't call Star it Wars that. Tales? Yeah, you'd call it Star Wars Tales.
Yeah.
You know, DC, you know, Elseworlds or whatever.
Obviously, yeah, especially after the story my brother kind of told me and CM about, like, Indiana Jones finding Han Solo's body.
Yeah.
You know, that was pretty damn cool. That was pretty neat.
Which is weird, right? Because you're like, Indiana Jones finds that. So Star Wars is before the Indiana Jones. But it does a long time ago in a galaxy far away. So it's pretty interesting. How long ago was it? And what's going on in that galaxy now? So, obviously there's a lot of doors to open with Star Wars. But if they're going to do a season 3, and I think IMDb does acknowledge...
But it's like you said, too, Sam. Daredevil now. Luke Cage. Iron Fist. Electro. Kingpin. Punisher.
Yeah.
Man, I mean, now you got a whole bunch of new toys you can play with.
Exactly. And again, too, like you've said before, it's like, you know, once again, it's like, well, we've done a lot of Avengers stuff. But it's like, you've already, I mean, okay, like, that's a fun toy box to play in, but also you've got Moon Knight. You've got other shit that you've given us recently.
And, you know, yeah, there's that, what if, you know, what if Punisher was an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.? You know?
Yeah.
You can have him and Nick Fury.
Yeah.
Interact. John Bernthal and Samuel Jackson.
Right, you know? Yeah. You've given us Falcon and the Winter Soldier. It's like, you know, what about that? You know, that other, you've given us a bunch of these other characters already in these other shows, but yet you're not using them in the What If yet. You're kind of going back to the well with some of the other stuff. I feel like we saw a lot of characters recycled that were in the first What If season. Yes. So I was like, I don't need more, you know.
I was thinking the same thing too, but you know, I was kind of like, I guess so. I guess we're just going to have to do like a whole nother season of this. You know, I was like, oh, well. But the what-ifs have been good, though, at least. Mm-hmm. At least you can say the what-ifs were really good. And episode 5 introduced a whole new character
that was
very well received. So, I mean, that's cool.
And, again, the actress that voices her is coming out in Echo. I don't know if that means that she could never do, like, a live-action
That's Corey, what they're saying. But... They're probably not.
Yeah.
They've already had this.
Okay. Okay.
They've already had this interview.
But interesting, too. And, again, how would you even, you know, how would you... How do you incorporate it, and where are you going to incorporate it at? Are you making her an Avenger? What are you doing? I mean, like, you know, it seems like she's running her own, you know, little world. What episode was it, AA, where I think it's where Carter first meets up with, where is it? The episode where it's her and the Watcher talking, because the Watcher talks to her a couple times in this show. But one of the
episodes... with Black Widow, the Russian episode, they talk in the 1602.
What episode is it, if you can remember? But remember where Carter and the Watcher are talking, and she sees the Mount Rushmore, and it's the Red Skull's face.
Yeah, the Red Skull.
And he goes, oh, in this world, the project that created, you know, in one world created Steve, and the other one created you. He goes, it goes wrong, and you both die, so there's no Captain America or Captain Carter in this world. So the Hydra, you know, takes over, and the Red Skull, I guess, becomes, like, in charge.
I can't remember.
Which is pretty dark in itself. I was like, oh, damn, that's kind of dark. The Mount Rushmore with the Red Skull on it only, you know what I mean? Like, fucking scary. So, like, kind of be like, where the fuck's that episode? You know what I mean? Like, I want to see that. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, it's just probably all bad guys.
Old Man Logan, right?
Can I give you a little spoiler?
Yeah.
Okay. For spoiler, everyone, too, this is like an Echo thing, whatever. It's minor or whatever, but, you know, it's anyone that hasn't seen Echo doesn't want anything at all. Tune us out right now, whatever. But just a minor thing. At one point.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Okay. So in Echo, I can't remember what episode it is, but some of the side characters are talking, right? And there's these tourists that they're in a Native American shop and they want to buy, you know, authentic Native American stuff, right? And one of the guys in the store goes, oh, you don't want that stuff, man. You got to get this stuff here. It's authentic. He goes, the stuff you're talking about, he goes, that stuff's all made out in Madrepore. And so you're like, oh, that's kind of cool. Just like a little bit, like, obviously we've seen Madrepore already. We know Madrepore and what it means. But again, anytime I hear like a name drop or something, that's very cool. Like to get a reference back, it's like, oh shit, we haven't talked about Madrepore since Falcon and the Winter Soldier again, which now seems like ancient history. I mean, like, it's like,
that's a long time ago.
You know, but there's so much other shit too. Like, you know, where's like the WandaVision story? You know, what if Wanda kept her kids? What if, you know, all these things were, you know, what if Wanda didn't give up that town or whatever, you know? I mean, so there's a lot of other things and movies that have come out now that I think they could refer back to for some more what if episodes. But yeah, I just wanted to see a couple that maybe went the other way where the good guys didn't necessarily win. Like, oh, damn, that would have been cool.
But that's what I was saying. Like, I was kind of worried of it being a connected story because I knew we weren't going to get any of that.
Yeah. Yeah, and you've got strong episodes in the first season, and then a couple weak episodes, and then this one you've got strong episodes, and you got a couple weak ones, you know. But for me, this one definitely, like, the Kahori episode really stole the show.
I think you could do what you're saying if there were just standalones.
Mm-hmm.
I think
mm-hmm.
you could do that real easy, you know.
Yeah, because it kind of shows that, like, oh damn, that's not necessarily the best outcome, you know. Yeah,
because it's cool when they're just standalone, like in that What If Spider-Man, the first one.
Yeah.
What if Spider-Man joined the Fantastic Four?
Mm-hmm.
Them four work so well together that Sue starts getting phased out. where slowly, I think in that issue, she ends up living with Namor. Oh, and they do some shit where she's able to breathe underwater so she can never come back out.
Oh, wow.
So, like, Reed loses her because she feels invisible.
Yeah.
When Spider-Man joins the team.
Damn.
So, it was fucked up.
See, I go a step darker, and then I have Reed become depressed and kills himself.
Damn.
He hangs himself with himself.
Damn,
that's fucking...
That's brutal.
That's grim. Ben Grimm.
Ben Grimm.
Terrible joke. Yeah, but overall, I mean,
sound like Doc Ock.
I know.
Terrible joke.
Yeah, terrible joke. Yeah. We found the rubber band.
I like when Peter still laughs.
I know. You know, what if I think it's one of those things that's like an upswing for Marvel?
There's just so much they can do. They can be so great. The series can be so great.
Yeah.
And it's just like CM says, it's like you're just not ready to let go of the Avengers characters.
Right.
And it's like, man, it's already done. It's over. Yeah. People felt like it was over in 2019. Like,
yeah. With Endgame. You called it Endgame. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but especially, like, I think it was novel to do it one time, but then like, okay, now like, don't go to the well so much.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's great when you ask people like, hey, you know, Elizabeth Olsen, you want to be Scarlet Witch again? And it's like, yeah, but we'll make her the Scarlet Witch. I mean, like, what if she hadn't lost vision or whatever? You know what I mean? Like, you could even take each show and each movie and do like a flip version, just one version. And I think that's a better story than necessarily like, you know, all these other kind of more, you know, like, what are they doing? Like we said with the Captain Carter thing, is she going to be kind of like the human watcher that goes to the multiverses? You know what I mean? Like, she's going to be telling, you know, Watcher, like, oh, well, why you can't intervene, I can, you know what I mean? So it's like, all right, you know what I mean? Like, but you're not supposed to be doing that. Like, you're fucking everything. So, you know what I mean? Like, and also, too, it's like, isn't there versions of you in other places? Like, there should be the other Captain, the other Peggy's, you know what I mean? So,
apparently not.
But it's a fun watch. If you love Marvel, you love the Marvel stuff, and you do have a hankering for it, you know what I mean?
30 minutes.
You can, yeah, 30 minutes. Yeah, there are 9 episodes. It's a fast watch. I watched it all in one New Year's Eve sick. So I was like, I'm in bed. I was like, I'll watch these.
Shit.
And I thought that in my like fever state, I wasn't going to remember. But then I was like, as I clicked through them, I was like, oh yeah, I remember exactly what happened because they're so short. So you really can't mess it up. And it's great to have the voices of the characters there. Any what ifs you'd want to see, Double A?
I mean, they're all with other teams.
Other teams, know? Other characters, the X-Men and things like that. Yeah.
It'd be cool to see the Red Daredevil, you know. Animated, you know.
Yeah.
It'd be cool to see Punisher. It'd be cool to see Wolverine. And we go to see Doctor Doom.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Spider-Man? How about Spider-Man? You know?
Yeah.
Well, I know. No. I forgot. Spider-Man, no, because Sony.
But he did come out in that first season, remember? He was the... He got the Strange cape.
That's right,
remember?
He did.
That's another voice that doesn't get used. So they don't use... No Chris Pratt, no Chris Evans, no Scarlet, no Tom Holland. So yeah, those four...
I think
four,
with Scarlet, they fucked up with her, though.
They could have kept her?
Well, yeah, because of the Black Widow shit.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. That's
they
right.
Fuck her bad on that one.
But see, there's another character too, like the Florence Pugh character,
the Elena.
They could have, you know. I mean, these are like they're not using the people that you're setting up for the next thing or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's like, okay, well, that's another way to like lead you in. You know what I mean? So, but I love What If. I think it's a great premise, and I think it's a great platform for them to introduce and show a lot of stuff that I mean I think is cool. I love that T'Challa episode in the first one. I mean, that's so fun. Mm-hmm. Again, I think people say that's his last work Marvel, last work as T'Challa. So if you wanted to see what that work was, that's in that season one. But yeah, solid watch. I think we had no doubt we were going to cover this one for sure. So
yeah,
I got nothing else on it. Double A, really? Mm-hmm. You guys watch What If, check it out, tell us what you think. We're going to put a survey up on our Spotify, be what your favorite episode was. I think it only lets me put 7 options, so we'll have to pick our favorite 7 and leave one episode out, which, you know, sorry if that one was your favorite one. But, go vote in that survey. Go check out our friends over at Collecting Weekly, guys. They're always doing great stuff, too, talking about all the newest, latest, greatest from action figures. Football this weekend, right? Double A
playoffs. First playoffs. Weekend of playoffs.
Win or go home, guys.
Win or go home.
This is it. If you're not a football fan and you want to watch a little bit, now is the time to check it out when it's super exciting because then this is the last of the games leading up to the Super Bowl. Anything else, Double A, you're looking forward to in particular coming out? You want to see
just this Sunday, True Detective. Yeah. You know?
Okay.
So
okay.
Yeah, I'm going to see The Beekeeper.
Oh.
That's coming out today. That's premiering today.
Okay. What's that going to be on?
Jason Statham.
Okay.
No, it's just at theaters right now.
Oh, theaters. Yeah. Okay, nice. You're going to go to movies. Yeah. All right. Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. I'll probably watch that Killers of the Flower Moon. I don't know if I'll watch it this weekend. I'm going to finish up Echo. And I definitely want to finish Twisted Metal. I'm looking forward to finishing
that. That was fun. Twisted Metal was really fun.
I'd be excited to cover, you know, any one of those for sure. And I definitely want to check out, you mentioned earlier, Loudermilk.
Loudermilk is good.
Our friend, too, Alfred, Alfred from Collector's Corp said there's a new comic out that's worth reading. I think he called it Ultimate Spider-Man. But he was saying that if you haven't gotten it yet, to pick it up, because he said it's really worth it.
What, another?
Yeah, I think they redid it, I think is what they said. And he said, yeah, that if you pick up one comic, yeah, he goes, first issue of Ultimate Spider-Man, the 2024 version, he says, really hits the spot. If you haven't picked up a comic in years, he says, pick up this one. And someone in the comments says here, there's like 15 different covers. So first off,
of course.
And then the other one, they comment here, in that one, he doesn't get his powers until he's an adult, right? And I was like, that's interesting. So
it's not by a spider.
So, huh?
It's not by a spider?
Well, no, I just think it means that, like, it's not a teenager that gets the spider powers. It's an adult man. So that's kind of neat.
All right.
And I just want to check our posts in Collecting Weekly, because I mentioned that in our Collecting Weekly post that if you guys had comments regarding What If, let us know that we would definitely talk about the... talk about your comments and what you were what you wanted to discuss regarding the show there. I don't know that I saw any in particular that stood out, but let me just double check to make sure. Yeah, well, we'll try to do that every now and then and drop a post in the Collecting Weekly group, in our group, that lets you know if you don't get a chance to tune into us live but you still want to comment, drop us a comment there about what you thought about whatever our topic's going to be, and then we'll address it here on the show. We're happy to bring that up and talk about it with you guys. Any thoughts on next week, Double A?
Not yet. Right now.
We'll figure it out. Lots of stuff that we're both watching our way through, so we definitely want to pick up on something like that, and stuff coming out, obviously, for well. Well, guys, I got nothing else. Guys, check out some football. If you're in San Antonio,
stay
Texas,
warm.
Or anywhere cold, please stay warm, stay safe, avoid roads if you can.
Yep.
You know, take care of each other. Don't buy up all the groceries, you know what I'm saying?
Actually, I didn't see any of that, so.
That's good. Yeah. That's a plus, right?
Yeah.
That's it. And something we like to say at the end of every show, guys, to remind everyone, if there's something that you want to do, something you want to accomplish, a hope, a dream, something that... a desire, by all means, guys, there's no time like the present. Seize the day. Go out and do it today. Dr. Strange, or then they call him Supreme Strange. Supreme Strange. I'm like, damn, maybe he is the Supreme Strange. He wanted to seize the day. He wanted to rebuild the world. So, yeah.
For a woman.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You sold me out for a woman. Don't forget your lucky deck. Guys, go out and do it. Seize the day. From one of our favorite movies, Dead Poets Society. Carpe diem, guys. Go out and do that. And then we would be remiss if we didn't quote the great Captain Steve Rogers. Not Captain Carter, but Captain Steve Rogers. Before he goes back in Endgame on the time heist, he reminds the Avengers that they must do whatever it takes, guys. So we encourage you also, sometimes in order to accomplish that hope or that dream, you must do whatever it takes, guys. So seize the day. Do whatever it takes. I'm CM Chuck.
I'm Double A.
We're Just Another Friday Night, San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast with P Breaks, live on Facebook and YouTube every Friday night. Guys, we'll catch you next week. Have a good night.